compare Arabic to the Spanish language, it is the most relatable. They are damn near identical. Fear of a Black and More Messiah Part 1 is on YouTube. Fear of a Black and More Messiah Part 2, when I get into some more stuff, is right here. I got copies. Part 1 you can find online if you Google it. That's the lecture where I get into all of the history. I don't have enough time today to go through it, but you'll have to just go back into that first series. But we're cataloging the series because we feel that we have to document what's taking place right now in Black history. All right? So, real quick, I want to explain, and like I said, the disclaimer, because a lot of people, I'm in Long Island. You know, you might have a lot of white friends. You know, we're not in Detroit or something. So, you know, we want to explain to you the mentality of a people who are basically in a matrix, or have our people in what is known as a matrix, meaning a psychological operation, meaning they have our people stuck in a reality to whereas they've been fed all facts all their life, right? All food, all media. Because if Donald Trump was right about one thing, it's the fact that the media does not tell you the truth about anything. It's manufactured, okay? But he's manufactured himself. So that's called Hegelian dialect. That's the pot calling the kettle black. Because all of them are lying. They're all playing psychological operations. When we think about Europeans, we're like, oh, these people won't harm us. It's beyond them, right? Whatever he's saying or whatever he's trying to do, it's not possible because I have white friends and they're not really built like that. Then we're looking at what they tell you, who is the enemy. The Russians are bad. The Arabs are bad. And all of these other things, and they have you looking outside of where a real threat exists at. But if that was the case, then, and they're also bringing forth an argument to say that black people, right, the hip-hop community, people from our hood are what is known as savage, right? And Donald Trump was like, yo, I'm ready to go in Chicago with the feds because these some savages, right? These people are barbarians. These people are, you know, they need to be dragged out into the square and doing all of these other things. How many people saw the case in Howard Beach where they lynched one of our brothers in the 80s, where they just caught the brother, or allegedly they caught a brother and said that he was responsible for the murder of a young white woman, right? By a show of hands, how many people know about that story? Okay, when you began reading the article, they started using all kind of language like monster and, you know, a demon and all of these other things. And they're like, yo, we need to do something about it. Like, we need justice outside of what it is that they're trying to give them. You know what I mean? These are Italians talking. Remember, Howard Beach, right? Where the mafia and the mob and all of these other people, where these Italians basically have a segregated place where it's an unwritten rule. Don't get caught out there after dark. That's a sundown town. You dig what I'm saying? You might, you know, they might be some dudes from Jersey Shore hopping out with a bat, you know? But what they don't ever want to do is they don't ever want to give you their history. They don't ever want to give you their story about how far they can go, or how savage they've been on this land, right? Or how they were the original ISIS, or they were the original terrorists on this land, and how they got this land, and how they got what is known as political power, or the perception of political power, was through the barrel of a gun and at the end of a sword. And when you look into the history, when you go into the papers, you'll be like, well, God damn it, look at this. These people have been carrying on and committing atrocities in the name of their white God, right? Who they say give them the right to this land, or give them the right to do whatever they have to do in his name, right, to our people. So when you like, yo, I don't think that, you know, They have it in them. They're scared of us. You know what I'm saying? They're not built like that. Well, I'm here to let you know one thing. They're preparing all over the planet. All right? For something. I don't know what it is. You tell me. What does it feel like? Or what is it looking like? Because this has happened before. It's called World War I and World War II. So all of the rhetoric that's taking place with Donald Trump creating situations that wasn't even created before. Why is he doing that? What is the purpose behind it? So we're going to get into some of the purposes. But these are just some articles where they talk about the lynchings that were taking place in the Jim Crow era. All right? A Negro is lynched as Kentucky killer. Alleged slayer is taken from jail into Virginia and there shot, then burned. The murder of Alfred Cranford and the ravisher of his wife was burned at the stake 2 miles from here at 2:30 yesterday afternoon in the presence of nearly 2,000 people. Have you ever heard any stories about young black men in Harlem or the Bronx or the slums of Atlanta burning somebody at the stake where 2,000 of us came out to watch that? Even in the islands, like even in places like, because remember, they're like, yo, we're bombing certain places because the ISIS is burning people at the stake. And there's 2,000 Iraqi citizens witnessing it. So even if we kill innocent civilians, man, who knows? They was there at the stake, you know. But when you look back into history, and this is what they refer to as Make America Great Again. This is what Trump doesn't want to talk about. But when he uses key words, remember, key words. We don't study this, but this is in one of their newspapers, right? So they are reporting their atrocities to their own people. So they study this stuff. They get into this information. Just Georgian soaked man in gas, burn him alive. Mob lynches Negro, seized in hospital. Mob stores South Carolina jail, put two men and women to death. Okay? So we're gonna talk about Donald Trump a lot tonight, okay? Because unfortunately, he has been one of the central figures in building up this quote unquote fear of a black and more messiah around the world. He's become the figurehead, all right? When I did a lecture, October the 11th, Columbus Day, last year, he wasn't president yet. But we were documenting what's taking place and what's building up inside of society that helped me see that it wouldn't be nobody but Donald Trump who was gonna be president.
What I see in Trump is a set of skills that are so deep and so exquisite, it would be hard for me to imagine anybody beating him. And so I've predicted he'll go all the way and win the presidency.
Can you hear that?
Donald Trump has a way with words and people.
I would be phenomenal. The women, I have many Hispanics working for me, many, many Hispanics.
We're rounding them up in a very humane way, in a very nice way, and they're going to be happy.
Vote for me, because we're going to make America great again.
But the media don't get it, and he doesn't appreciate it.
You know, some of the media is among the worst people I've ever met. And I think a pretty good percentage is really is a terrible group of people.
Scott Adams, prolific author, blogger, and creator of Dilbert, thinks they're all getting trolled.
Well, I'm saying, I see a flamethrower. I think the flamethrower guy wins in the stick fight.
Though he doesn't support Trump or any other candidate, he believes that Trump is in fact a master wizard.
The idea of the master wizard hypothesis says that there are some people in the world, living people, who are masters of persuasion. They've got a linguistic gift for influencing people, and they're using actual technique. What I saw in Trump was someone who was highly trained, and that a lot of the things that the media were reporting as sort of random insults and bluster and just Trump being Trump, look to me like a lot of deep technique that I recognize from the fields of hypnosis and persuasion. So let me give you a few examples of the technique that Trump uses. There's something that I call the linguistic kill shot. And what that is a engineered set of words that essentially changes an argument or ends it so decisively, I call it a kill shot. So one of the ones that Donald Trump used was when he referred to Jeb Bush being a low-energy guy.
Very, very low energy. So low energy that every time you watch it, you fall asleep.
Yeah, I'm going to take more energy tonight. I like that.
And when he referred to Carly Fiorina as a robot.
Like a robot. Bop, bop, bop. Like a robot.
Or Carson is nice.
Ben is a nice man.
He's actually a really nice guy.
All of these have the same quality. They're words you haven't heard in the political realm before, so they're sort of virginal words that he can use the way he wants. They don't have a lot of baggage with them. But they also perfectly fit what you are already thinking about these people. They weren't random insults. And once you hear it, you can never get it out of your mind. That's how powerful it is. You notice that he insults people that come at him.
I'm telling you, anybody that would view it that way has to be a little bit of a deviant.
And he also compliments people quite effusively when they're nice, or at least they're not bothering him.
I think they like me in a certain way, which is nice. It's always nice to be liked.
So what he's done is he's created a fairly large gap between insulting Trump, where he'll take you down, or being nice to him, where he'll take you up.
It sounds like you're saying I have leverage over the Republican Party, so they better be nice to me.
Well, essentially, I want to be treated fairly. That's true. I do want to not be nice.
You go against him, you know there's a little bit more to lose. And an anchor is something big and visual and emotional that takes you off of whatever you were thinking before just because it's a bigger thought. So, for example, when Trump was in his first debate.
You call women you don't like fat pigs, dogs, slobs, and disgusting animals.
That was a terrible thing for him to answer with a direct answer, but he didn't do that.
Your Twitter account?
Only Rosie O'Donnell.
Immediately you go to this big visual, everybody knows her, his base probably has a negative feeling about her, and all the headlines became about Rosie O'Donnell instead of, is Trump a sexist?
I blurted out the name Rosie O'Donnell and the place went crazy, and it really had a big impact on her questioning.
Kind of brilliant. He does the same thing with his idea for immigration and for the wall. The wall is this big, visual, magnificent thing in your head.
It will be a real wall. It'll be a wall that works. It'll actually be a wall that will look good.
A big, beautiful, powerful wall. It can have a gate. It can have a door.
It has a tremendous, beautiful, wide open door. Nice big door.
Even if you hate it, it's still big and visual, and it takes all the attention in that direction, and that's what he wants. One of the things that Trump does really well is he uses a type of linguistic judo. For example, there was one interviewer who said you're kind of a whiner.
Rich Lowry says that you are the most fabulous whiner in the world. And
instead of saying, no, I'm not a whiner, Trump embraced it like judo. He took the force of the label and said,
I am a whiner, and I'm a whiner, and I keep whining and whining until I win. And I'm going to win for the country, and I'm going to make our country great again.
So he changed whiner into the biggest voice for change. And he did it with just a few words. It's amazing. Likewise, if Trump says anything about capitalism in the context of the Pope, it's just not going to come out right. So instead, Trump doesn't take the bait.
What do you say in response to the Pope?
I'd say ISIS wants to get you.
It's such a big, bold thought.
You're talking about capitalism, you scare the Pope?
I'm going to have to scare the Pope.
All your attention just goes to that. He uses vagueness as a tool. This is a trick I learned in hypnosis class. Sometimes you want to tell a story in a way that lets people fill in the blanks with whatever would make them the happiest. So if Trump has a vague idea about foreign policy,
just like I have the Chinese banks in my buildings, they listen to me, they respect me.
Or a vague idea about the economy.
My economy will expand so rapidly, we're going to take jobs back from other countries.
Or a vague idea about how to handle ISIS.
I would end ISIS forcefully.
People fill in the blanks with brilliant plans that are their own plans. It's more of a strategy than you imagine it is. But he has another thing going for him. He's developed the Trump persona over many years. He can do what nobody can do as a politician. He can change his mind.
Raising the Social Security retirement age to 70 Is that still your plan?
Not anymore.
He can say, I'm not going to tell you what I'll do. I'll just hire good people to do it.
I have the smartest people on Wall Street lined up already.
And he also can tell a joke. He can be outrageous.
I'm worried if you're president, I'll get deported. All right? That's what I'm worried about.
Never be. We're going to try like hell to keep you here, Bill.
You see apple pie and flags and eagles coming out of his ass when he talks. A lot of people ask me what could bring down Donald Trump. Probably there's no defense, and that's why I predicted he probably will win the presidency based just on skill.
I've said that if Trump wins, it might change how we see the world. Not just how we see politics, but how we see humans and how humans are influenced and how little reason has anything to do with what we do.
In my book, How to Fail at Almost Everything and Still Win Big, I write about the moist robot idea. It's the idea that humans are essentially robots that are made of meat. In that world, emotion and influence and all the techniques that Trump uses are really the only things that explain what's happening in the world. Reason will never be a satisfying explanation of what you see. We're going to build a wall. We're going to create a border. It's good.
So, a lot of the people who call themselves black, our people, are now suddenly hypnotized by Trump. Have you seen it? Huh? Have you seen people around you start saying, now, you know what? I think I'm riding for him. You're like, wait, what? They're like, nah, did you see the speech that he said that the news was fake? Like, he's down for us. I'm like, really? That's all it took? And they are what they're describing as being under this Trump spell. He is utilizing the skills of, you know, persuasion to basically get a lot of things going. And then when you look at how he interacts with the media, right? It's almost as if everybody's on code. It's like they're following a script. You dig what I'm saying? Because they're not really getting back at him. He'll shut them down and they'll just be like, okay. So I'm like, damn. It's like they playing a role or something. This shit reminds me of The Apprentice. So real quick. Get into this. When we talk about fear of a black and white messiah, we're talking about a genetic, biological fear that of people who are identified as inferiors based off of a genetic level have fear not of just you, but of all people of color on this planet. Because once they have realized that they are what is known as the inferiors based off of a genetic makeup. Right? Not because you don't like them. No, because of the fact that because of the European genome, if the European mixes with anybody on the planet, guess what the offspring will not be? A European. If you have a child, he would be known as a biracial, right? But he's still part of the race. But with the European, if they have a child, that child is not part of their race anymore if that child is not mixed with another European. Okay? There have been movements, there's been multiple wars that have taken place as a result of that with the dominance. So now you have inside of what is known as the United States of America, and also, because keep in mind, I'm not just talking about Trump in America, I'm talking about the whole globe. I'm talking about the system of racism, white supremacy, or what I refer to as white inferiority, all right? They're all working in tandem. Don't fall for the muse like people are not rocking with each other. No, the people in London is rocking with the people in Israel is rocking with the people in America. Please believe it. The Council of Foreign Relations and all of these other things, they're not disconnected. What they do is they come together as a cabal and they destroy and they take over and they rape and they pillage and they plunder all other lands around the world where their people don't exist. So this is an article from the Nature magazine, and it says, proportionately more deleterious genetic variation in European than in African populations. Okay? quantifying the number of deleterious mutations per diploid human genome is of critical concern to both evolutionary and medical geneticists. Here we combine genome-wide polymorphism data from PCR-based This result is wholly consistent with previous work showing higher overall levels of nucleotide variation in African populations than in Europeans. EA individuals, in contrast, have significantly more genotypes homozygous to the derived allele at synonymous and non-synonymous SNPs, and for the damaging allele at probably damaging SNPs than AA's dues. What that's basically saying is, based off of genome testing, because remember, they have broken what is known as the genome genetic code. They've broken down our atoms and our genetic makeup all the way down to the genome. And by doing such, they are able to do a lot of things nowadays. That's why you see the rise of what is known as designer babies. How many people have heard of designer babies? That you can now program your child to have wavy hair, blue eyes, and be blue-black. You dig what I'm saying? You can manipulate the height of a child at this point. They have designer biogenetics where you can actually create a plant that glows in the dark. You can create a cat that grows in the dark. Based off of scientists breaking down the human genome, the atom all the way down to the genome level, they're saying even with this, by doing such, and keep in mind, they're not necessarily trying to put this out here for the public to know. This is what scientists and genetics and all of these other people behind the scene know. This is a fact that they are genetically inferior. They are the most genetically inferior group of people on this planet. What does that do? That creates a psychology. What does that do? That creates a psychosis. What does that do? That creates a mind state of a people who are willing to do anything by any means possible, by any means necessary to maintain dominance by way of power. Because that's what we're dealing with, power dynamics. And the fact that there's a dominant society that exists right now, and they exist amongst other societies, other people in their society who they identify as subordinates. And what would you do if you was in power? Would you not do anything and everything in your power to remain dominant? And the people who are subordinate, who are more in population than you are, you would have to do what? You would have to work in you would have to work and utilize different fields of warfare. 90% of warfare is what is known as deception. It's not physical, okay? When you see drones blowing things up and the tanks come rolling in and whatnot, that is an end result of a psychological warfare that has been taking place. That's an end result of a spiritual warfare that may be taking place. That's not the end all be all to war. War starts in the mind first. War is ideas and ideologies. So now you have an American society, or what is known as Americana, the fact that they're like, yo, we're not welcoming Islam, or the ideas that Islam represents, or the ideas that Islam, because remember, if they bang it on Islam, they bang it on the Nation of Islam, they bang it on the God bodies, they bang it on the fact that you walking around saying that I'm God and I can prove it, that God is inside of me. They banging on the fact that you're saying that, yo, I ain't with you. I'm not going to church. I'm not buying into that. That's what they banging on. They banging on the occult. They banging on metaphysics. They banging on anything that's not in alignment with dominant society's programming. Okay? One of the threats that they identified as a black messiah who came amongst us as a messenger to the people was Dr. Martin Luther King. Okay? Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated by the government.
There are literally two Americas. One America is beautiful for situations. Millicent this America is overflowing with the milk of prosperity and the honey of opportunity. This America is the habitat of millions of people who have food and material necessities for their bodies, culture and education for their minds, freedom and human dignity for their spirits. In this America, millions of people experience every day the opportunity of having life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness in all of their dimensions. And in this America, millions of young people grow up in the sunlight of opportunity. But tragically and unfortunately, there is another America. And this other America has a daily ugliness about it that constantly transforms the buoyancy of hope into the fatigue of despair. In this America, millions of work-starved men walk the streets daily in search for jobs that do not exist. In this America, millions of people find themselves living in rat-infested, vermin-filled slums. In this America, people are poor by the millions. They find themselves perishing on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. In a sense, the greatest tragedy of this other America is what it does to little children. Little children in this other America are forced to grow up with clouds of inferiority forming every day in their little mental sky. And as we look at this other America, we see it as an arena of blasted hopes and shattered dreams. Many people of various backgrounds live in this other America. Some are Mexican-Americans, some are Puerto Ricans, some are Indians, some happen to be from other groups. Millions of them are Appalachian white. Probably the largest group in this other America in proportion to its size in the population is the American Negro. American Negro finds himself living in a triple ghetto, a ghetto of race, a ghetto of poverty. A ghetto is to deal with this problem, to deal with this problem of the two Americas. We are seeking to make America one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now let me say that the struggle for civil rights and the struggle to make these two Americas one America is much more difficult today than it was 5 or 10 years ago. For about a decade, or maybe 12 years, we struggled all across the South in glorious struggle to get rid of legal, overt segregation and all of the humiliation that surrounded that system of segregation. In a sense, this was a struggle for decency. We could not go to a lunch counter in so many instances and get a hamburger or a cup of coffee. We could not make use of public accommodation. Public transportation was segregated, and often we had to sit in the back and within transportation within cities, we often had to stand over empty seats because sections were reserved for whites only. We did not have the right to vote in so many areas of the South. And the struggle was to deal with these problems. Now, certainly they were difficult problems, they were humiliating conditions. By the thousands, we protested these conditions. We made it clear that it was ultimately more honest, deserved to exist. To use the philosophical analogy here, racism is not based on some empirical generalization. It is based rather on an ontological affirmation. It is not the assertion that certain people are behind culturally or otherwise because of environmental conditions. It is the affirmation that the very being of a people is inferior. This is the great tragedy of it. I say that however unpleasant it is, we must honestly see and admit that racism is still deeply rooted all over America. It's still deeply rooted in the North, and it's still deeply rooted in the South. Now this leads me to say something about another discussion that we hear a great deal, and that is the so-called white backlash. I would like to honestly say to you that the white backlash is merely a new name for an old phenomenon. Not something that just came into being because shouts of black power, or because Negroes engaged in riots in Watts, for instance. The fact is that the state of California voted a fair housing bill out of existence before anybody shouted black power, or before anybody rioted in Watts. It may well be the shouts of black power and riots in Watts and the Harlems and the other areas are the consequences of the white backlash rather than the cause of it.
I could get into more, but he was shortly killed after speeches like that. That's not the Martin Luther King that they let you hear. You understand what I'm saying? This whole speech is very powerful. I suggested you go ahead and Google that. I believe it's Martin Luther King, the two Americas, right? But he's describing conditions that haven't changed yet. He's describing conditions that can apply to today. When they saw that messianic force waking up in a Martin Luther King, in a Malcolm X, that's when they had to stop the rising of the black messiahs. This article right here shows that there was a settlement from the King family to the American government where they proved that they killed them. Okay? The widow of Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. says she feels vindicated by a jury's finding in December 1999 that her husband was the victim of a conspiracy, not a lone assassin, and says it is the duty of the Justice Department to look at the information presented in the Memphis case. I think if people will look at the evidence that we have, it's conclusive, and I think the Justice Department has a responsibility to do what it feels is the right thing to do, and the just thing to do. Coretta Scott King told CBS, a jury of six blacks and six whites deliberated only about 3 hours before returning a verdict in a civil lawsuit brought by the King family. They sued Lloyd Jowers, a 73-year-old retired Memphis businessman who claimed 6 years ago that he paid someone other than James Earl Ray to kill King. The Kings were awarded $100 in damages. See how they do our people, right? But he got monuments, streets named after him that they make money off of. They parade him around. He's a holiday. But this is what they're going to give to his family in damages? Okay? Martin Luther King, as well as Malcolm X, as well as Elijah Muhammad, as well as Huey P. Newton, many of the quote-unquote liberators or freedom fighters of our race were targeted by the federal government because they possess what is known as a messianic force. That messianic force, it's even, I'm going to read it, it's basically documented that if that messianic force was to be felt, or if that messianic force was to wake up inside of these speakers or inside of these revolutionaries, that was the most thing that the U.S. government feared, okay? Because our people will begin to wake up to what's really going on. They had the power to snap our people out of the deep sleep that we find ourselves in. They had the power to expose what is known as the Matrix. And you will begin to see, as a result of them taking out our people about 40 years ago, we haven't moved any further since. We've actually begun to move backwards, okay? So here's a federal FBI file on Martin Luther King, where they talk about him being a black messiah and what they feared in him and why he had to be eradicated. The FBI initially monitored King under the Racial Matters Program, which focused on individuals and organizations involved in racial politics. Although the FBI raised concerns as early as March 1956 that King was associated with card-carrying members of the Communist parties, King's alleged ties with communism did not become the focus of the FBI investigations under the existing Communist Infiltration Program, Common Field, designed to investigate groups and individuals subject to communist infiltration until 1962. In February 62, Hoover told Attorney General Robert Kennedy that Stanley Levinson, one of King's closest advisors, was a secret member of the Communist Party, da-da-da-da-da. They utilized that like they utilize groups today and be like, yo, he's down with ISIS. Or he's down with a, you know what I'm saying? This is the boogeyman, the same way that ISIS is the boogeyman. I'm just saying that communism back then was a way in to begin to infiltrate, to quote unquote have people scared, like they have people scared about, ooh, ISIS is gonna come and get you. How many terrorist attacks have happened in America ever since ISIS was coming to get us? The jury is still out, well, the jury is in about 9/11 and who was involved in that. It is not who they say it was. Okay? So they justified killing millions of people around the world in the name of a boogeyman. Now, and then when you do the research, they're saying, no, ISIS is a bunch of criminals and thugs that the CIA and other, what is known as private military contractors, came over there and they deputized them and they armed them, and that's, you know, that's their boys. You feel what I'm saying? So it's not who they say they are. These people are, these people have contractors that are around them that are training them. I'm gonna show you that as well tonight, all right? Hoover responded to King's criticisms at the Bureau. Hold on. In August 67, the FBI created a COINTELPRO against black nationalist hate groups, which targeted SCLC, King, and other civil rights leaders. King was identified as a target because the FBI believed that he could become a messiah who could unify black nationalists should he abandon his supposed obedience to white liberal doctrines and embrace black nationalism. In the last few months of King's life, the FBI intensified its efforts to discredit him and to neutralize SCLC members. So they basically were saying that if the brother became conscious, he was going to become a problem. So when they saw, based off of their surveillance of him that was very thorough, that he was beginning to wake up, then they had to push the button. Okay? So you'll begin to see that. A lot of times in our history where there's people amongst us, even it doesn't matter what they're involved in. That's what we also have to understand, because we're under this impression that a messianic force has to be somebody who is quote unquote a reverend. That's not what a messianic force is. A messianic force could be a Tupac Shakur. A messianic force could be somebody in your hood who has the ears and the eyes or the hearts and the minds of young people, young warriors. And they'll do anything that he says at a snap of the fingers. Because the feds will be like, yo, if he wakes up to who he is, he could snap his fingers and these people could potentially, you know, cause some damage. Or they could wake their people up. Or they can do things that will basically, you know, kind of disrupt what it is that we're trying to do. All right? This is just, this is a book called Waiting for the Messiah from Joe Lewis to Martin Luther King Jr. A lot of people are not familiar with Joe Lewis's history in Black America outside of being a boxer. He was himself a messianic force because he brought hope. And he brought, you know, being a boxer who was beating up a lot of Europeans during the era of the Jim Crow and things of that nature. He was seen as a champion for the people's champ. Then Muhammad Ali came forward later on and was 100 times more militant than him. And he was also the people's champ, but he was more outspoken than Joe Lewis. Joe Lewis was the people's champ, but he was still kind of like, you know, he was white friendly. You know what I'm saying? He wasn't militant. He wasn't a nationalist. They identified Muhammad Ali, though, with being a nationalist. Why? He embraced Islam in a time where that was taboo. You dig what I'm saying? He helped Malcolm X's recruitment process, or he helped his wave by saying, yo, I'm down with the Nation of Islam. It's almost as if Floyd Mayweather would jump forward right now and be like, yo, I'm conscious. And I've changed my name, Floyd Mayweather, to, you know, Abdul Rahman El Bay. Niggas be like, damn. You know what I'm saying? What is he into? Yeah. And he's like, yo, read this book. Right? And then he would use all of that swag, all of that bravado, all of the wittiness of himself, and even the money that he has to fund movements, to fund whatever movement that he was a part of. That was akin. And when you look at Muhammad Ali, you know, he's champ. You know what I'm saying? So he had a lot of people lining up to join the Nation of Islam just because he joined the Nation of Islam. All right? Preventing the rise of messiahs. 40 years ago today, a bullet severed the spine of a man who many the world over thought was a prince. We have all seen the pictures of the hotel balcony where the prince stood and fell, suddenly by his entourage all pointing, presumably in the direction where the bullet came. They're talking about MLK. One man was not standing, not pointing, but kneeling by Martin Luther King's body, presumably checking to see if or that he was dead. That man, Merrill McCullough, was an undercover police officer who had infiltrated King's circle. According to the Time magazine, he worked for the Central Intelligence Agency as far back as 74. What interest could an intelligence agency have in a man who plainly believed only in peace? In August 67, 4 months after King called the U.S. government the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today, 3 months after 30 members of the Black Panther Party marched armed into a California state capitol and onto the front pages of newspapers worldwide, J. Edgar Hoover, the head of America's domestic law enforcement agency, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, issued the following directive. The purpose of this new counterintelligence endeavors is to expose, disrupt, misdirect, discredit, or otherwise neutralize the activities of Black nationalist hate-type organizations and groupings, their leadership, spokesmen, membership, and supporters. By hate-type organizations, Hoover explained that he meant such groups as the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. That's who Stokely Carmichael and them were a member of. That's where the term Black Power comes out of. Okay, they were juxtaposed against Martin Luther King's nonviolent movement. So the nonviolent movement, I don't want to compare it to Black Lives Matter in that sense because you may have a, you know what I mean? It's not the right comparison because they were doing a lot of boycotting, they were doing a lot of protesting, the bus boycotts and things of that nature, but they were considered to be peaceful and subversive. Similar to Black Lives Matter, right? They're not known for being a militant organization. Their rhetoric doesn't speak of picking up arms, exercising Second Amendment rights. They're not necessarily getting up there and doing lectures and stuff like that, exposing the government or exposing, you know, the hidden hand. They're just like, yo, you can't kill us, I cannot breathe, you know, hands up, don't shoot, things of that nature. But Stokely Carmichael and the SLs, they were like, yo, pick up your guns, okay? Forget all that, nobody's gonna put their hands on me, I'm not walking in no march and just peacefully getting snuffed. That's not going down. So they considered him to be a, you know, a thorn in the side of the system. I'm reading all of this because I'm bringing you up to speed as to what's taking place right now in this government, in this quote-unquote Trump administration, where they are going to launch a campaign against the quote-unquote Black Messiahs, all right? So Hoover, right, who stayed in power longer than he stayed in power through 7 presidents, right? Because, you know, everybody in the hood know what the feds do. Feds made a sweep, you know what I mean? The feds taking pictures and all of that stuff. Well, the feds cut their teeth breaking the backs of the conscious community of the 60s, 70s, 80s, 50s, 40s, 30s, started with Marcus Mosiah Garvey. They broke his back, they broke that movement, infiltrated it, crushed it, sent them back to Jamaica after they put him into jail, and they prevented the rise of our people's liberation to the point where the majority of our people are dying from what? Our people perish from a lack of knowledge. They don't know themselves. They don't know who they are. So as a result of not knowing who they are, they don't know where the hell they're going. Okay, do you know how easy it is to just put out people in any direction right now? You can't sit a child down and say, yo, where are you gonna be in 10 years? 8 years ago, they would say the president. Now they don't know. They can't give you a, they'd be like, I just wanna be alive. I just wanna be alive. Our people, even our elders, where are we gonna be at in 10 years? You don't even want to hear what they're about to say. You feel me? So our people are severely misdirected. A lot of organizations, a lot of quote-unquote post-civil rights groups got compromised under the threat of coercion, getting their heads blown off. Trauma. What do you think happened to the psyche of our parents? My father was around back then. He was like, his whole generation got traumatized because their heroes, the giants, was all getting clipped down one by one. Bang, 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 bang. And then the other ones was on a run, and the other ones was putting them under jails, giving them life sentences, similar to what we see today. Look at what the hip hop community is enduring, right? The Biggie and Pop murders. All of the quote unquote leaders and whatnot, who they identify with, they've been neutralized. They've been compromised. They toothless tigers. By a show of hands, how many people seen Al Sharpton lately?
Sick.
No, I'm dead ass. What happened to Al? No, beyond the weight loss. Because he said he was drinking the tummy flattener. The tea tenders or something. I don't know. I'm just saying, wasn't he Donald Trump's buddy, buddy pal? Where were they at during the quote-unquote Trump election season? I didn't see him. Where has he been in these Trump-era days? Where's his critique? Where's his intellectual critique? He's the invisible man. That's what he is. So you gotta remember, money talks now. They buying these Negroes out. Yo, here, I'm gonna give you the bag. Have a seat. I don't wanna hear from you. Don't even get on Twitter. I don't even think he's on Twitter. So Hoover had a directive, prevent the rise of Messiah who could unify and electrify the militant black nationalist movement. Malcolm X might have been such a Messiah. Martin Luther King might have been one. Stokely Carmichael, Elijah Muhammad all aspired to this position. King could be a very real contender for his position should he abandon his supposed obedience to white liberal doctrines. Not only Martin Luther King, our people as a whole. I don't believe in liberals. I'm sorry. I apologize. I do not believe in a white liberal. I don't even know what that is. Okay? In the streets, that's like two people playing you. You know what I mean? Like, that's not real. Oh, black people, we need to come together and march together. We need to come together and hold hands together. We need to come together and cry together. We need to come together and lay down together. By a show of hands, how many people know what negative affirmations are? All right, you know, everyone is familiar with praying. They say get on your knees and pray to your most high power. Well, when you affirm, it's similar to praying, but it's more powerful than praying because you're speaking it into existence, right? Me and a young God was talking earlier, and he was like, yo, I feel that I'm God. Well, your affirmation would be getting up and being like, I am God, right? And I don't want to spook anybody in the crowd that's religious and whatnot. When we say that, what we're talking about is the fact that the God force is inside of you. It's not outside of you. So we're not identifying with an idol or a picture on the wall when we're saying God. We're not saying God like we can walk through a wall. We obey the laws of this quote-unquote world. They call it the Hermetic Principles or the 12 laws of the universe. When we reincarnated on this planet, you have to abide by the laws of the planet, but you still know that you still have qualities of a God. You have the power to procreate, right? Be fruitful and multiply. You can give birth to life for the sisters in the audience and the brothers in the audience. You can recreate yourself. You could think of things in your mind, right? And they can come into fruition. Everything that you see around you right here come out of the mind of people. It comes out of the mind of man. All is mental. So when we're identifying with the God concept, we're saying that inside of us and inside of our minds and inside of our heads, we know that we're creating the reality that we exist in. If I pay my rent, it's because I got up and did something to get my goddamn rent paid. Okay? I don't pray and then the rent is in a cabinet when I go into the kitchen. You know what I'm saying? And there's a loaf of bread. And behind a loaf of bread, it's a stack of cheese. That's not how it works. You got to put what is known as sweat equity, sweat labor, right? Because you got people that's like, yo, Jesus paid my bills. I'm like, well, goddammit, what about the person next door to you who's a Buddha? And they always pay their bills. What about the person downstairs that's an atheist? And they always pay their bills. What about the person who's a Satanist? And they always get their bills paid. Everybody's on welfare, spiritual welfare. Somebody's paying everyone's bills. No, you paid your bills. Okay? You paid your bills. You created in your mind the number that you needed, and you made that number manifest by doing something to bring forth that number into fruition, or the federal notes, or whatever it takes to make your rent. You dig what I'm saying? So these people have what is known as a messianic force. White liberal doctrines will confuse you from the truth as to who you are. Nobody in this room, you know what I mean? This conversation that we're having right now is a conversation that we have to have as a race. You don't have to apologize for being there for your race when your race is in a race. If you don't know that there's a race taking place, you go ahead and ask a white person, who you running with? They're like, I'm running with my race. You can't get mad at that. They want to win. Right? That is something that's innate inside of us as human beings. Everybody wants to win. There's some of our people that want to see other people win besides us. Those will be identified as race traitors. Those will be the people in the marathon trying to trip you. You know what I mean? Or giving you water with cyanide in it. They're not identifying with the fact that their race is in a race with another race. And they are helping other people get ahead by doing what? Helping them in the race. We help them in the race. to leave the planet. By show of hand, how many people see Hidden Figures? Hidden Figures show a group of black women, right? They called them computers before that there was computers. Because in the movie, they showed you how AI is taking over, or how they created a component of a mechanical aspect of what is already inside of you, black woman, okay? You were the original computer because you give birth to everything. So you help them navigate and leave the orbit of the planet. Oprah Winfrey is coming out with a show, a movie called The Immortal Cells of Henrietta Lacks. Uh-huh. Henrietta Lacks, they use her cells to coat the spaceships. Her melanin was used to coat the spaceships in order for the ship to leave the planet. Uh-huh. They could not penetrate the planet because the spaceships were burning up. They had to coat it with her immortal cells. So anything that they are doing, technology, the computers, all of this stuff is a composite. It's built off of our brains. It's built off of the original computer, which is the brain, the mind, right? So the black woman, who's always been the mother of civilization, quite, you know, it wouldn't be anybody else to help Europeans, who is her child, genetically, allegedly, leave the planet. If they came from somewhere else, they would have known how to leave the planet. Mm-hmm. They would have had the mathematics. It was her, it was Cookie. They had Cookie in the movie from Empire, right? But they flipped it though, because when you watch these movies, the subliminals taking place. The overall subliminal message was this: black woman, mother of the universe, all set, Isis. You can come and sit with us, but you can't go to our bathrooms. You can't drink from our coffee thing, because they showed you that in the movie. She was in a room full of white men who wouldn't even look at her and talk to her. And she was helping them leave the planet. And they patted her on the back and then fired her. So the lifeblood of a lot of corporations that exist right now are black women's mamas, okay, who are in the workforce, being subjugated by the same white woman that y'all went marching with in the 60s when y'all ran off, when y'all turned y'all back on the brothers. Or most recently, what took place with the Million Man March, or the, you know, the march against Donald Trump, where you had these white women who were claiming that they were suffering under white power, but they gave birth to these white people. I don't get that. What kind of, that don't even make sense. How you marching against white men when you gave birth to them? What do that got to do with black women? And then they was at the march talking about black men. What, they're telling black women what they should be doing with their sons. But were black women telling white women what they should do with their sons? Because their sons was the reason why we was marching. One of them, the police brutality, shooting our sons down in the street, right? The crookedness in government, the quote-unquote patriarchic system where it won't allow women to express themselves and it's so misogynistic. Well, that system and that whole thing was set up by these people who they gave birth to. So I'm not falling for that. The liberal thing is, that's two wings of a vulture. If the presidential race didn't show you that, when you didn't even have a choice, it was Hillary or Trump, and you was rocked any other way. Right? So the best that both wings of the vulture had to offer the world in 2016 was Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, two war criminals? You know how much blood both of them got on their hands? Especially Hillary? Killery? The war against the Sith, all right, where they're labeling the Nation of Islam, the black Muslim groups. I'm talking about all of this because I'm going to bring it up to date as to what's going on right now. Trump is talking about sending the feds in Chicago. Don't think that he's talking about Chief Keef and them. Do not think that he's talking about going to get the drillers. Chicago is the mecca of black consciousness. Uh-huh. and so is Detroit. Okay? Those are the pillars of our black people. Louis Farrakhan is in Chicago with the Nation of Islam. Donald Trump is like, yo, I'm going to war against Islam. He didn't tell you what Islam he's going to war against. He said, I'm going against extreme Islam. What's more extreme Islam than the black man is God? That's who they went to war against. They went up in Chicago and killed Fred Hampton. That's what they're talking about going to do. That the feds went into Chicago and bodied Fred Hampton, who was a Black Panther. The feds went into Chicago and grabbed Jeff Fort, El Malik, with the El Rukas. The feds went into Chicago and created some of the gang wars by snatching Larry Hoover and some other people over the streets and created what you see going on right now. Did they tell you that El Chapo was in Chicago? Did they tell you that El Chapo has Chicago, one of his outposts in America, with the Mexican mafia and all of the cartels, was Chicago. Okay, they got him in Brooklyn right now at the fence, but one of his outposts. So a lot of those murders in Chicago, that's cartel business. Did they tell you about the black sites in Chicago where they were renditioning people? Some of the gang members who are getting killed are getting black. They are renditioning them, meaning that the feds or the police is in all black, hopping out of vans, hitting with the chopper, killing people, and saying that the gangs did it. Or they're grabbing people off of the streets, taking them to the black sites, interrogating them, killing them, dumping them, and they're like, yeah, this gang war is going on. Do you know about that? Do you know that the Justice Department put out a story on the quote-unquote Chicago Police Department as being the most, one of the most, St. Louis was number one, and I believe Chicago came second, the most corrupt police department in America. You mean to tell me that they're not killing our people? Their mayor is Mossad. It's Rahm Emanuel. He's a piece of shit. Okay. He's another war criminal. That's the mayor. And before that, it was Daley. And he's crooked. Counterintelligence program. These are some of the questions. Does Elijah Muhammad have a will? Is the NOI incorporated? And whose name and where is the NOI bank account? And whose name and other NOI assets, such as mosque builders, school builders, the newspaper, Elijah Muhammad home, and NOI businesses? What happened to the NOI after he died? All of these things got taken care of. And then what happened? They said that his son was working with the boys. Okay. That's how they infiltrate you. Where's your money coming from? They came in and disrupted the Nation of Islam through the means of COINTELPRO. Collapsed it business-wise. Collapsed it economically-wise. Collapsed their buildings. Took their buildings. The fish markets and all of these things. This, if you want to go on and see this information, it's on genius.com. That's the website that shows the lyrics and whatnot. Ran by Jews, they have a lot of this information up there because, you know, I guess they're cataloging and stuff, but it's a good read if you want to go ahead and get your information on it. Range, goals, and prevention of a black messiah. So keep in mind, the feds did a sweep, right? So what if the new messiahs was brothers and sisters from the hip-hop community who was getting them M's? What if it was a whole group of people who was exemplifying messianic forces? Because I'm going to give you the definition to messianic forces. Right now, we're not in the quote-unquote realm of morality that a lot of people like to apply to what they think is a messiah, right? We're saying that there's some messiahs out there that bust their gun. True. There's some messiahs out here that taking penitentiary chances. They're in their Detroit Red stage, right? They're in their early stages of waking up to who they are because they've been a part of a culture that is basically dictating, yo, that's how you gotta roll, right? Back in the days with the Panthers, back in the days with Martin Luther King, they didn't necessarily belong to a musical culture, or they necessarily didn't belong to a culture which was like, yo, this is how you gotta move. This is what you need to do. And if you follow it word for word, verbatim, your ass will wind up in a grave or a jail cell. They wasn't in hip-hop. Because going back to what I was saying about culture, the hip-hop culture has five pillars. The griot, which is the master of ceremony. The DJ, which is the brother on the wheels of steel. That would be the drummer in Africa, right? the graffiti writer. We go into Kemet and we look at the hieroglyphics or the Medunetta, and we're amused by all of the carvings on the walls. Well, goddammit, the artists or the Renaissance people of back in the days, those are your graffiti artists or your graphic artists or your people who use the cameras in order to do new media and other things these days, right? Then you also had your breakdancer. Well, they got dancers right now doing the Millie Rock and all of these other things. And you had dancers in West Africa, and you had dancers in the Americas doing rain dances. Then you had other ceremonies where you had to dance in order to bring down the deities, in order to do what? Take the deities would take you over. It would mound the person, right? If anybody ever saw a powwow, or if anybody ever been to a voodoo ceremony, or if anybody ever been to the tunnel, okay? Or if anybody ever been to one of those raves, or if anybody ever been anywhere while people are dancing, and there's liquor present, which is called the spirits, weed is present, which is called the sacraments, the drum is present, which is called a beats, right? The beats, the drums, you go to a turn-up club, that drum is talking to your lower chakra. It's activating you when you hear that shit, a future beat, or, you know, panda, or whatever. You know what I mean? People start turning up. That has its roots in African culture. There was something called a war drum. When we heard the war drum, we get activated. Niggas would get in their shit. It will begin to possess us, right? And when we become possessed, we could become possessed with the spirits of the warriors in order to go to war, in order to win the war. Everybody has their routine. LeBron listens to Future, and Jay-Z, and Lil Wayne, he listening to those war drums before he goes out there. He throws the powder up, and he gets it in, right? You had Tyson training the Tupac and other things. This is what we do. But it's done on different levels because we belong to a newer culture right now. Our culture that is pervasive is hip hop. But as an alchemist, you have to be able to go into hip hop and decipher it for its ancestral origins and the power that it has, and why they're trying to dumb it down, and why they're trying to devolve it, and why they're trying to basically niggerize it, because of the power that exists within it. So the power that exists within it has the power to rise up messiahs amongst us. There's no one messiah. The people are the messiahs. The messianic forces exist within all of us. Okay? It exists in all of us. Because when they was rioting and when they was turning up in the 70s, would you think it was just Malcolm X out there by himself? When Marcus Garvey was doing parades, it was 30,000 to 100,000 Africans. All of them had the force, but he was the figurehead, or one of the figureheads. He was one of the more dominant voices. That's why when they quieted him, they was able, you know, all of that stuff began to break up into the Moors, into the Nation of Islam, and all of these other different groups. It splintered. So these are some of their goals. Prevent the coalition of militant black nationalist groups. In unity, there is strength, a truism that no less valid for all of its triteness. An effective coalition of black nationalist groups might be the first step towards a real Mau Mau, which is the Black Revolutionary Army in America, the beginning of a true black revolution. The Mau Maus were the ones who you see with the long dreadlocks, and they picked up the machetes and caught bodies. They caught wreck. They took their country back. So they're like, yo, we don't want these niggas to get together. Because when they come together, that's where the power is at. By show of hands, how many people been to Super Bowls? How many people been to All-Star Weekends? How many people been to Greeknik or Freaknik's? How many people been to Gap? How many people been to Summer Jam? God damn it. All right. So when our people come together collectively in large numbers, right? Do you feel the force? I've been to what is known as we have Dance Africa in Brooklyn in the summertime. They call it the Band Festival, right? No relations to Africa Band Bottom. The Brooklyn Academy of Music, right? They have something called Dance Africa, and then later on the 4th of July weekend, they have the International African Arts Festival right there. They used to have it at Boys and Girls on Bed-Stuy. Then they moved it downtown. There's no better place that I can exist in Atlanta. Got something called a Malcolm X Fest. That's where I go to charge up. Okay, that's my charging station. to go amongst my people where we ain't scheming on each other. The energy is not at a low frequency, it's at a higher frequency, because we're dealing with our ancestors, we're dealing with the culture or aspects of the culture, because I forgot to say, pardon me, that the fifth element of hip hop is culture. That's the five. Culture translated as consciousness. That's the fifth pillar. It's the fifth pillar that they broke and they had the shit missing. That's why the whole thing began to fall apart. Once you break any pillar that's holding up this temple or was holding up your culture, if they remove a pillar, well, goddammit, you in trouble. So after they infiltrated the quote-unquote conscious movement or the golden era of hip-hop, they call it the golden era of hip-hop, goddammit, that was the conscious movement back then. Okay, them niggas was conscious. You know what I mean? Like, they was getting it in, doing what the youth are doing today, wearing historically black university hoodies and stuff like that, wearing flat tops, rocking the gold medallion, rocking the Africa medallion, right? Talking about, you know, all of these things that are related to Kemet. That was taking place in the 80s through the music. So once they brought forth Snoop Doggy Dogg and all of that West Coast gangbanging and all of this other things, N.W.A., Jerry Heller, they began to neutralize that pillar in consciousness. They took out the Islamic influence. When I say Islamic, you might think about dude at the Arab corner store. That's not what I'm talking about. Arab and Islam is two different things. All right? It's two different things. They don't have nothing to do with each other. I'm talking about I self, Lord, Master. I'm talking about people who come out of West Africa who utilize science, technology, mathematics, and other things to navigate and to do what it is that they're doing. I'm talking about engineers, right? That's Islam. I'm talking about the same people who brought Europe out of the Dark Ages into what is known as the Age of Enlightenment. That's Islam. That's what I'm talking about. So they don't want us coming together. Prevent the rise of a black messiah who could unify, electrify the militant black nationalist movement. Malcolm X might have been a messiah. He is the martyr of the movement today. Martin Luther King, Stokely Carmichael, and Elijah Muhammad. I said that before. Prevent violence on the part of black nationalist groups. This is of primary importance and is, of course, a goal of our investigative activity. It should also be a goal of the counterintelligence program to pinpoint potential troublemakers and neutralize them before they exercise their potential for violence. Tupac Shakur. Mm-hmm. Tupac Shakur. He clapped the police. And he was ready to clap a few more when he put out Machiavelli, Illuminati. Right? Jeff Ford with the El Rukin. Some of these gang leaders, they have a propensity to do what? Become black nationalists, but to turn it up. When they had the cop killings over the summer in Houston, no, Dallas, when they had the cop killing this summer in Baton Rouge that we're gonna talk about tonight, that has a huge impact on why Donald Trump is president today, right? They saw violence taking place. Remember, all of America stopped. They was like, yo, you niggas, you better apologize for this shit, because we're not moving forward until you do. Many people forget that. They have black people under pressure. We all had to come forward and apologize for the fact that a black nationalist or a black militant was like, yo, enough is enough. I can't take no more. Y'all killing too many of our people. We going bonkers. That's in their doctrine right there. So anything that they have to do to stop the rise of any kind of organization who will threaten the safety of their quote-unquote white society or dominant society, they have been doing it from the time that this organization was formed. This organization has not gone anywhere. It still exists. Prevent militant black nationalist groups and leaders from gaining respectability. Remember the 90s when they were putting out all of those movies like Boys in the Hood? Remember the conscious character of Boys in the Hood? He was lame. Remember Menace to Society? Remember Sharif and all of them? He was on his way to college. He got Peter Rolled and whatnot. It was like, I don't want to hear that conscious shit. They were ridiculing him. Then remember in Don't Drink Your Gin and Juice, while in South Central, they made a complete mockery of consciousness. Redfish, Bluefish, two fish, one fish, two fish. I'm black, y'all. I'm blickety black. I'm black, y'all. So,
my milk of magnesia.
My milk of magnesia. You know what I mean? So, in popular culture, they ridiculing consciousness. They're like, yo, that shit is for birds. That's some lame shit. Why many of us took so long to arrive at consciousness is because we attributed it to something that was lame, something that was soft, something that was outdated, something that had no bearings on coolness. This was a protocol of an organization to do that. It started taking place in the blaxploitation movies. The goal of discrediting black nationalists must be handled tactically in three ways. You must discredit those groups and individuals to first, responsible Negro community. Secondly, they must be discredited to the white community, both the responsible community and to the liberals who have vestiges of sympathy for militant black nationalists simply because they Negroes. Third, these groups must be discredited in the eyes of the Negro radicals, the followers of the movement. The last area requires entirely different tactics from the first two. Publicity about violent tendencies and radical statements merely enhances black nationalists to the last group. It adds respectability in a different way. By a show of hands, how many people seen black nationalist groups online banging on each other? Who familiar with that? Who familiar with the fact that agent provocateurs often come into the community like fires, and then those fires become forest fires? They behind the scenes gossiping like lames. They running around dragging people's names through the mud. They running around with gossip campaigns behind people's backs. All of that is agent provocateurism. A final goal should be prevent the long-range growth of militant black organizations, especially among the youth. Specific tactics to prevent these groups from converting young people must be developed. There's a reason why I made sure that we brought my young brother Chess to the event today to be a part of this, because ever so often, these conscious organizations are not catering to the youth. Because if you lose the youth, you lost the future. All of this shit that we doing don't mean nothing, because it's going to die with us. While they go ahead and they become victims of this society that has been set up strategically through think tanks, right? And through strategy to clip them and to put them into graves and to put them into cells and to prevent that messiah that was sent that's within them from rising up. Where do most people wake up? Behind the wall, right? When they got 80 years to life, they're like, yo, I get it now. It's too late, my nigga. Game over. It's a wrap. Because if they take your freedom, you know what I'm saying? If you 30 years old and you get 80 years, well, guess what? Let's do the math. That's called low-intensity warfare. That's slow death. It's a form of warfare still. They gave Black Panthers 40 years in a box. There's some of them with four life terms and all kind of other stuff buried alive as we speak. This is no, you know what I mean? Like, what we do is not no walk in the park. Now when you begin to realize some of the people who are at work against your people waking up, I'm gonna breeze through some of this because we gotta get some more information, all right? They help fuel what is known as the war between the Black Panthers and the U.S. organization Karanga, the brother responsible for creating Kwanzaa. They had drama and bodies got dropped, all right? And that split the movement in two, where people were taking sides. Bunchy Carter lost his life. Rest in peace. All right, Malcolm X assassination memo. All of this stuff is identifiable. Definition of Messiah, a professed or accepted leader of some hope or cause, which politicals promise, the expected king or deliverer of the Jews, okay, it has different meanings. A Messiah, all right, it also has biblical meanings that applies to people's biblical narrative. For everybody who is into religion, you understand the concept of the Messiah, all right? It speaks of that. Well, I'm here to let you know that that's real. And Messiahs, you're looking for somebody to come out of the clouds. That's not what it is. That's mixing mythos with information, or that's mixing up fantasy with real life, fact and fiction. All right? The Jews, the Ashkenazi Jews, the Khazar Jews, you know what I mean? The people who live in the Hasidic Jews, the dudes with the Goldilocks, with the curls, and they wear all black to, huh? In Crown Heights, Williamsburg, and whatnot. They wear the hats with the big brim on it to signify Saturn with the box on it, and they have usurped another culture that was African in its origin. Well, they got vans that they ride around talking about the Messiah's coming. These people, though, where you may be like, ah, oh, they're just a group of, well, goddammit, these the landlords of everything. They, on the game of Monopoly, well, goddammit, they the ones that got Boardwalk Walk Place, Atlantic Avenue, and all of that. They are also some of the progenitors or some of the owners of what is known as media. Record business, movie business, and all of these other things. All of these are run by the Jews. And even if they don't look like the Hasidims, remember, they all have an ulterior motive, and they all are following the doctrine of doing what? Ushering in their Messiah by any means necessary. So they will do anything within their creative powers to discredit your Messiah. And they always have an eye out for your Messiah in order to do what? Line them up. Character assassinate them. How do they do that? Through the media. Okay? How do they do that? They do that by not giving you no work. They do that by giving you a dress. They do that by putting you in a role where they're like, yo, I got 20 million if you kiss that nigga. Will Smith. And he went for that. Dave Chappelle, I'm loving your show. I like that. You're going hard. You're doing your thing. We want to renew your season. We got $500 million. Check out this skit where you're wearing a dress. Discredit the Messiah amongst his people. So niggas like, I don't fuck with that nigga. I don't want to hear nothing that he got to say. He's a bird. You feel me? He's a dove. He wore a dress. This is some of the things that they'll do in order to coerce you, you know what I mean? To play yourself out of position because they have their ulterior motives, all right? They're trying their best to justify their existence. They have to have a Messiah in order to complete their story. Look how hard Israel is going to even be recognized by the world, right? Messianic, of or relating to a Messiah marked by idealism and an aggressive crusading spirit, right? So when you see our people going super hard, they crusaded for their own people. Malcolm X was crusaded, Martin Luther King, even though I'm not a nonviolent, I'm not with that. That's not a doctrine that I follow, but he was still on his mission, okay? He was still messianic. He still had impact in what it is that he did. He had an admirable messianic zeal. He was seen as a Jesus to people that were in religion. They were like, that's our Christ. So when they killed our Christ, guess what it did to our people? Imagine the trauma. Imagine the mental trauma. Remember, wars are for the hearts and minds of people. So if they could stop, if they could break your heart, right? And if they could put your mind, if they could confuse your mind, and if they could confuse, and if they could do things to your mind and have you basically mentally defeated, then they got you. The body gonna go where the mind tells it to go. Okay? So messianic age, in a theological term referring to a future time of universal peace and brotherhood on the earth without crime, war, and poverty. Many Abrahamic religions believe that there will be such an age. Some refer to it as the consummate kingdom of God, paradise, peaceable kingdom, or the world to come. I'm bringing this up because guess what? All of the Abrahamic religions have a duty. They have a purpose, and that's to get what? Into the messianic age. And they are playing these war games. They are playing this theater of war. They play these political games with our people because time, and they will do anything in their powers in order to reach the time. Like go to war. They're like, yo, we got to go to war with Islam, and this is the apocalypse. Sign me up. That's what the evangelical Christians that are in office right now, that's what some of the Jesuits, that's what some of the Zionists like Netanyahu and these other people, that's even what the Iran, that's what even some of the people in Iraq who fall under Islam are all in agreement that they're going to move forward to do. So when you see a lot of politics heading in the direction, you're like, damn, this looks like we're going to an apocalypse. It looks like they're all in the same, you know, it's almost like they in on this shit together. Well, you got to remember, people's religion trumps their loyalty to government and state. Okay? So a messiah complex, because you can't have a messianic people in a messianic time without messianic or messiah complexes, because that arise from that. So we have to be able to identify some of the quote unquote neurosis or the neurological situations that exist amongst our people, where we have false messiahs or false prophets amongst us. And you got to be able to spot them out, because, you know, a lot of people are trying to wear that messiah title. When an individual holds a belief that he or she is destined to become a savior, a messiah complex is a state of mind in which an individual holds a belief that he or she is destined to become a savior. The term messiah complex is not addressed to the diagnostical and statistical manual of mental disorders, and it is not a clinical term nor a diagnosable disorder. However, the symptoms of the disorder closely resemble those found in individuals suffering from grandiose delusions or delusions of grandeur. The form of delusional belief is most often reported in patients suffering from bipolar disorder and schizophrenia. When a messiah complex is manifested within a religious individual after a visit to Jerusalem, it may be identified as a psychosis known as Jerusalem syndrome. Now, I don't know anybody that's more delusional than the white man. I don't know any other group of people with more of a messiah complex than these goddamn Neanderthals. Okay? And as a result of what it is that they fed us, we got messiah complexes ourselves. But we're looking at them like they're the great white saviors of all of humanity, with the right hand while the left hand destroys all of humanity. How the hell does that happen? How are you the savior of humanity when we can catalog the existence of the race of the European, specifically the ones who came out of the regions of the Caucasus Mountains, the Indo-European Aryans, the ones who went into what is known as Indus Kush and implemented the whatchamacallit? The caste system. Okay, the color system, and adopted the Hindu color system and then exported that around the world, which initiated what we know as the virus of racism. There's no more messiah complex that I've come across. Psychiatric diseases, manic state of bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, delusional disorder, substance abuse disorders, grandiose delusions are a subtype of delusion that occur in patients suffering from a wide range of psychiatric diseases, including 2/3 of patients in manic states of bipolar disorder. Half of those with schizophrenia, patients with grandiose subtype of delusional disorder, and a substantial portion of those with substance abuse disorder. How many people know about Europeans and their substance abuse? And I'm not, like I said, I'm not here pointing fingers and, you know, trying to single out people, because of course amongst our race and of course amongst different other races, you will see all of these things arrive. I will point it out in every different race. But what I do want you to see is how this permeates what is known as the biggest religion on the planet. And that biggest religion that's on the planet, shout out to my brother Blue Pill, because he brought that out. It's called Americanism. You think that America is a Christian country. You can Google that. It's not. The founding fathers said that they were not Christians. They were Masonic before they were Christian. Okay? And they also believed in a combination of different deities and gods. They did not have Christianity as their main religion. Similar to how somebody who practices Santeria, they not a Christian. They doing that shit on the surface to fool you. Okay? In the same way that somebody who's in Palo Mayombe, they're not into Christianity or Santeria or Yoruba or Voodoo. What is called the cult means what is hidden. What is hidden is the shit that we do when we go home that only we know about. Right? So I live in an area in the Bronx where when you go outside and you be amongst the Spanish people, they got their crosses and rosary beads. They like, yo, Jesus and the saints and all of that stuff. But the minute they get in the crib, they turn African on your ass. Like this. They speaking in tongues that you like, yo, where is that from? They opening up closets. They got pots and shit like that with black deities in the closet. So they in the closet Africans. Huh? Shango. Huh? You saw Beyonce with the Oshun with the yellow dress come out at, what was that? Super Bowl or the Grammys? Right? So occultically, in a hidden realm, outside, for those who know. Remember, it's for those who can see and those who know. Like, I can walk somewhere and people are like, yo, what's going on with the weirdo over there? Look at this guy. Right? They don't understand what's going on because they are not a part of that society. It's a secret society. They're not on that frequency. They're not on that wave because behind closed doors, right, or on the occult realm, people understand what's taking place. They know what they see. Like when you see the beads on some of the brothers' necks, right? You're like, okay, I know what he's into. Or I know what she's into. So Europeans behind closed doors also practice black magic. All right? Black magic matters. That's one of our hashtags. Okay? Black magic matters. I was on a radio show the other day with my brother Tahir, RBG. One of the things that he was saying is, amongst our people, they don't deal with the African traditional systems, but there's a group of our people that do. Those are the drug dealers. You can talk to them about black magic because they understand. In all different walks of life. Why is that? Why is it if I go into Mexico, what you see as the Mexican cartel is really groups of occult groups? When you see all of those beheadings and all of those sacrifices and a lot of that violence, you think that that's drug talk. You think that's stick talk. You think that that's a drug deal going bad. When some of those are sacrifices to a deity that they follow and they worship called La Moreta. That's a deity. They have a deity who's a god for the misfits. It's a god for the trappers. They have a trap god.
I'm dead ass.
Who is it?
And it works in that god because they feed that god works for them. It's almost like a genie bottle. You rub in the bottle, but you gotta feed the bottle, and that bottle, that genie will pop up and be like, what you need me to do? Okay? Well, I need you to protect us, make us invisible from the knocks, you know what I'm saying? You know, point my enemies out for me, show me the signs. Things like that take place. You go into Jamaica, it's called the Obeah Man. The Obeah Man protect the drug dealer. You go into Voodoo, the Zoe's got the voodoo. Huh? And they sending people up and they feed their gods. Right? Blood sacrifice. Okay? You go into the Dominican Republic, copying them in Washington Heights, they got the pot in the closet. They wearing the beads. Right? You go into Cuba, you go into the ghetto of Cuba, Palo Mayombe. You go into the favelas, Santeria. Right? So our people understand that black magic matters. But if you go into the woods where the KKK is at, they got a god too that they feed. When I was showing you those articles earlier, when they hung people and they burnt them in front of 2,000 people, do you know that was a ritual? That's a ritual. That's a blood sacrifice to Zeus or some shit. I don't know, they got different deities. But some of them practice voodoo. Some of them practice Palo Mayombe. Some of them practice Santeria. You could go to Haiti, they're in the mountains right now. Mm-hmm. Look at George, look at Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton. Those are priests and a priestess. Disgusting. Huh? Facts. So these people understand that there's a subtle power that helps things on this planet. It's called the manipulation of the minerals. I know what I probably spooked y'all out with all of this talk about bloodletting. And what I'm saying is, I'm speaking about information that is known as being taboo. I'm not saying to go out, not right now, and go find you a rooster. In the year of the rooster, that is. This is the year of the rooster. You know what I'm saying? I think that would, you know, I would say to do your research, do your DNA test. Find out where your blood comes from. Man, know thyself. Find out who the hell you are. You might not be the same as me. Okay? We may be from different geological locations on a planet, but if you find out that you're from the Congo, I would suggest that you look into Palo, because that's the operational system of that land. You might jump into Santeria, some other shit, and things ain't working for you, because in your DNA, that God that I said is inside of you, this innate, it's trying to, or your deities, your ancestors, in your bloodstream, you have the blood of all of your ancestors. Billions of years, maybe. Millions of years, maybe. Whatever the hell they was doing is in your blood. You can't erase that. You can't bleach it out. You feel me? You can't. It's still trying to come out. So that's why they say that you have to look within. Stop looking outside of yourself, because the more you look outside of yourself, you're giving something outside of yourself the power over. Right? That's not power. That's not how you can take back power. The power is when you see that within you, and then vicariously within the group structure, the people that you are on frequency with, the people that you belong to, they might not be your human complexion. You might go into India and see some people that look completely different from you, and they might be on the same frequency. They might be following the same path that you may be following. They may be able to give you a key. Right? So you don't shut yourself off from receiving information, light, and all of the other things that humanity has to offer the original people on the planet. How are you going to be the fathers and mothers of civilizations that you're not willing to receive from your children? Right? That doesn't make sense. So the reason why we say, yo, go out there, build with whoever you want to build with. Right? Build bridges with whoever you want to build with. Align yourself with whoever you want to build with. But always know who you are in your mind. When you look in that mirror, that's what's most important. It don't matter about who you chopping up with, because that's going to determine how you behave around them. Are you going to be subservient? Are you going to be standing on your square in your proper persona as you are who you are? Like, I'm not bowing down to no, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to be inferior around you. I'm not changing my tone to make you feel comfortable. I'm not becoming violent, because you know we bilingual, right? We talk like this amongst each other. When we get around Europeans, we're like, you don't say, Bob. You know what I mean? Like, you don't got to do that. You don't have to suppress your energy. You don't got to suppress your nature. You don't have to suppress the spirit that you have. You don't got to suppress the African within you. You don't got to suppress the Aboriginal, Indigenous, Native American within you. You don't have to suppress the Black Messiah within you to make other people feel comfortable. That's not the stage of the game that we're in right now. Because what are they doing? You feel me? Like, they let it all hang out. They like, yo, I'm inserting my greatness around you niggas to make you feel uncomfortable. And the only way that you would feel uncomfortable is if you don't know yourself. But the majority of our people don't know they self. So they don't know what the hell is going on. So they're lost. You understand? They're in a state of limbo. So a lot of people are beginning to fool our people, trick our people. They have our people in a perpetual state of fear now. It wasn't like that a few months ago. As a people, if you are in fear, you're not going to be thinking right. You're not going to be eating right. You're not going to be speaking right. Your relationship with the next man is not going to, you're going to just want to knuckle up and fight because you're engulfed in fear. Right? You ain't feeling yourself. You're like, yo, what's going on? Trump is coming. Once again, giving somebody outside of you power over you. What that got to do with you? What are you going to do to you? What can he do to you that hasn't been done to you already? I don't understand that. How the hell, if I'm standing here in 2017, coming out of 1990 New York era, crack era, tunnel era, D-sets, all this great shit, I'm like, what's Trump gonna do? He don't pose a threat. The only threat that we have right now is us against us. We are biggest threat. The ignorance, the level of ignorance, the level of fear, the level of cowardice, the level of, you know, just the level of unbalancedness. Because I'm all about balance. I'm all about being able to level things out. So, you know, I do ratchet Mondays. Yeah, gotta balance it out. But I'm approaching it from a place where I'm not letting it control me, because I have control, I have awareness or consciousness over what it is that they're trying to do during Ratchet Monday. So I'm watching it with the perception or with a different kind of glasses than a person who's like, yo, I'm watching Love & Hip Hop in order to find out somebody who I should be like so I can follow their every step. That's a weak mind. That's a weak mind. You are sheep. You're cattle. You know what I'm saying? But if you approach it where you're like, yo, I want to be able to see the neurosis that our people are under. I want to be able to diagnose the motherfucking, the sickness of the ratchet culture. So I'm going to watch this, because when my sisters start acting like Jocelyn, or when my sisters start acting like the basketball wives, or when my sisters start swirling and twirling, and when my sisters start dealing with each other like how, you know, how they promoted with Erica Mena and the other girl, you know what I'm saying? I'm gonna be able to know where that comes from, because you know your people, right? You know what people used to be into versus what they into now, and you're like, well, goddamn it, how did that happen? Programming. So in the second half, we're gonna deal with the programming, how the programming has come about, what to do in order to take the programming and to flip it, reverse engineer, take the power and make it yours, because like I've been saying all night, the power that they fear the most is within us. So thank you. How long is the break for?
We're gonna do a 5-minute break.
Just a quick 5-minute break. We got the CD, some t-shirts for sale. They told us we couldn't basically bring all of the stuff here because of the agreement that we have with the facility. So we brought some light stuff. I got some lectures, Fear of a Black and More Messiah 2. The one that came before this 2.5 hours, I did that in Baltimore. So 5 minutes, y'all, and we'll be right back. Thank you.
Get into something right quick? All right, bet. It's lit, man.
Thank you.
Look for my
Everybody, if you can, take a seat, please. Yo, can I get everybody up here for a second for a group picture? Group picture, group picture, group picture. If I can get everybody up to the front. Please, please, please. Group picture, everybody come to the front for a second for a group picture. Let's go, group picture, group picture. Everybody to the front. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Much appreciated. We love everybody that came in tonight, thank you. Much appreciated. All right, let me take this picture. Come through, come through. Rude picture, rude picture, rude. Rude, I'm gonna need you. Instagram.
Rude, you take the first one.
Yeah, rude picture. You got that, rude. I'm team up. Come through, come through. Rude picture.
Get you before we leave.
All right, guys.
Slide up here so I get a look.
Brother, show off on real quick to open up with some bars. Then I'm gonna do about 30 more minutes. Then we're gonna do some Q&A. We're gonna close it out with the young Chess. Send us home. I look forward to doing this sometime next month. I want to come back to this community center. If we could do this maybe twice a month, that would be dope. You know, I got a lot of people that I work with, a lot of teachers. The brothers are just eager to teach.
Yes.
They just want to be amongst the people. You know, it's a lot of us. You know, ain't too many of us, but I got my brother Blue, I got my brother KT, Mama Pill, and some other associates that we deal with. And, you know, our purpose is to serve the the people and to bring this information, to bring the people together. So if you in this room right here and you from Long Island and you never saw the person next to you, I'm encouraging you to get that person's information. Or if you got a business card, give them a call, because it's about networking and socializing at the end of the day. You feel me? This is not social media where we just click and like and whatnot. We amongst each other, we got to take advantage of the fact that we are all in the building with each other, because we may never even see each other ever again. So with that being said, I want to let the God come and do his thing, all right? Let him know that y'all appreciate him. Give him a hand.
You already know.
We're trying to get that on a lot of things, so. Let me do that walking around, though, man.
Hey, what's going on? I go by Show Walk. I'm a Red Sea representative. You can check out some of my stuff. I do the battle rap thing as well.
Facts.
R&B, stuff like that. I'm going to just give y'all some bars, man. I really came out to support the brother. And
That's it.
Please allow me to take this time to address the public. I was going to wait for the mainstream to address it, but it seems they're afraid to admit that cop killing is legit, equal rights shit. Janie's still seeking poetic justice. Before they kill us, they say, I'll teach you a lesson, but it's pointless to teach a corpse, so what lesson was it? You pull us over hoping we got drug-infested luggage gunned down by the neighborhood watch for dressing rugged. Shit, I'm impatient, I never wait. Then they be shot when our shots ring, cause our skies are Freddy gray. It's time for cops' blood to flood the strip like when the levee break, the levee broke. I'm impatient, they sleep, they was never woke. I mean, it could be the violence, it could be the drama, it could be the babies, it could be their mamas, cause there was no daddies. We was stuck on some welfare, babies growing up and raising themselves. Who the hell cares? It could be the police. Could be that 4 pound. They got on riot gear. Oh, they screaming, it's war now. If it come down to that, well, fuck it, that ain't wrong. That I can understand. Who gives a fuck? That ain't Trayvon. Huey Newton. Ain't no justice. Man, it's just us. Middle fingers to the world. Cause they screaming, fuck us. Never needed nothing but us. But we don't trust us. Just look how we judge us. Look how we show face in a white man land who look at one as a whole race. From bottle to whole case, get indicted, we know a case. Life, capital F, so we pray for a lower case. It's a picture on the man. He copping 3 balls. That's 3 plates, and pray to make it home to know he's safe. Guess I'm in tune with my fishing tools. That's why I'm leaning for notice B.
Spoken word, baby, talk.
That was balls. I'm gonna switch it up to the whole poetry thing real quick.
Spoken word.
So the man has to try. And whether he plans well, if that man fails, the man has to cry. Well, maybe not literally, or even confessing in the cross and hate to lose, but understand that there's a lesson in the loss. A person afraid of the truth has to lie. So he and an honest person clashes. Why? Because the truth is always revealed as time passes by or flashes by like light when illuminated. So liars leave quicker than bugs when the room is fumigated, consumed with hatred and hostility because he never knew love defines me. Oh yeah, that reminds me of the time we didn't love life. So we did things to jeopardize it because we insist on loving ice, cars, whores, being the center of attention. I'm still waiting for my round of applause. See, no gauze and band-aids can heal at home. Oh no, they say he'll be hurting and slowly dying until he feel that tomb mark with a waste of a man who had a plan but couldn't stand to stand in front of a mirror and look at an image that didn't reflect a brother, father, or uncle resembled a crook. Face of a stick-up kid, eyes of a killer, heart of stone that's grown to live the life of a gorilla. Then I wondered why I was in the cage. I always wanted to be known. I was always in the stage. I had sight but didn't use it, so I need glasses. Why? To finally notice myself being left behind as time passes by because the world told me to brace myself. You know, we all hard-headed and shit. I mean, I walk softly and cautiously as I pace myself. I only landed in situations in which I place myself. So I think I'm against how to space myself. See, I was tracking myself like I erased myself and replaced myself with somebody I couldn't identify with. Thus, I was supposed to chase myself. And by the time I was finally able to catch up and embrace myself, shit, I got scared. Because the hardest thing I ever had to do was face myself. I never quit, never stop, never die. I mean, the last part is a lie, but the other two I refuse to accept. See, I live life well aware of my actions, so I refuse to regret something I did, said I took a part in. Amen.
Okay.
Besides, there's no doing it over like a movie. There's no cut. Take 10. Small men learn to analyze, adapt, and take control of a situation quicker than a religion can take a soul. So I'm still singing, still flowing, still living, still learning. And in the essence, I'm still growing and still going to give you my truth, growing uncut. So as I give you my soul, I will pour it somewhere because too much might break your heart. So from the portion that I give you, you can take your part and use it to better you. I mean, learn from my mistakes. At least that's what you better do. See, it's better you than me in your shoes. I might get comfy, cozy, and not want to leave because in my shoes, in my past, there were times that I did not want to breathe. And that's literally me wanting to take my own life physically and destroy every chance, blessing, and talent given to me. Luckily, I had children who was no longer living for me, so I'm still here. Still, every night I thank the Lord that I'm still growing and allowing to live, love, and learn as I am still growing because I am still growing. Appreciate y'all.
Talk to him.
Respect
that. You can
follow me on social media. You can follow me on Instagram, 5050 underscore show off. Or you can just go on Google search and put in the word show off, and I'm going to pop up. I work hard. I'm going to
show off. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Spoken word, man.
That was a joke. Round of applause.
Poetry jam. All right. That was good. Deaf Poetry Jam in the house.
All right, man. We're gonna get into about 15 to 20 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Of that cloth. Then we're gonna go to Q&A, and then we're gonna have our brother Chess close us out, the Young God. All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight, for showing us love, for being in the building, and let's continue this lecture. Y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
All right. So we ended on the Randos. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit. All right. The God Complex. Highly dogmatic in their views, request special consideration and privileges. Okay. Narcissism. Narcissism is usually considered a problem in a person's or group's relationships with self and others. So the funny part about all of these descriptions is it can apply to the Donald Trumps of the world. You know what I mean? It can apply to some of your bosses. It can apply to some of your neighbors. But it can also apply to some of these niggas on my fridge. It can also apply to some of the people in our community. So we know that mental disorder is not prejudice. We know that mental disorder doesn't just exist amongst one race of people, right? We know that if you live in a society that promotes mental disorder, you begin to see and reflect on many different people of many different backgrounds, of many different races. It just so happens to be at this point in time in history that your president is a person who follows all of these traits, okay? But we're gonna get into the aspect of our music real quick, all right? Of course, this can apply to the conscious community, all right? And what we saw taking place in the conscious community, which was the Messiah complex, which was some of the God complexes, which was some of the narcissists, some of the most ignorant narcissistic behavior that I've seen in a very long time, okay? So, the Black Messiahs. By default, the messianic energy drives masses of people in a positive or a negative path, like I was talking about earlier. The messianic force applies to both driving people on positive and negative. So you got people inside of hip hop that's mumble rapping, but they got messianic force. Okay? And they telling you to whip up that work. Put that pink molly together in the month. So the picture right here is images of our good brother Jimi Hendrix. All right? That's a picture of Beyonce when she was in Kemet. That's a picture of Tupac Shakur excreting data or light codes and vibrations, meaning that our people emit light, okay? Meaning that our people, if you look at people, their special glasses, because keep in mind, the human eye can only see 10% of the light spectrum.
I can't see your physical, I can't see your visible aura by just looking at you. I can see if a person has a glow, but they have special kind of glasses that can see the light that's emitting from a person's what is called Merkaba, all right? So when you look at some of these performers in concert, you will begin to see that they emit a level of light or spectrums of light that almost are akin to being a star. Solar rays, there is streeting light, there is streeting the light spectrum and things of that nature. These lights, these light codes, these vibrations are what people pick up on. What do the hood call it? Oh, well, he was just catching the vibe. That's just the vibes. You know what I'm saying? If somebody's turning up, they're like, yo, I'm, you know, you're seeing all of that light, you're seeing all of that energy on display. And it has an effect on our people. It's almost hypnotic. When you see Beyonce doing her thing, look what she do to the sisters. Look at the beehive. Okay? She don't even gotta say nothing. She just turned. Like, oh my goodness. So even in what is known as organized sports, you just saw the Super Bowl. Look how much energy that Super Bowl was generating. Look how many people tuned in to see the Patriots versus the Falcons and whatnot. You know what I mean? Look at what's taking place at the All-Star game. All eyes on them. They like gods on that court, right? Because they have these messianic forces, all right? Messiahs and the masses of the people, they know about these messiahs. They know about this messianic force. They know about the influence that some of these people have on the hearts and minds of the people. So if they can't control you, they will do what? They will kill you, okay? Do not sleep on that industry and what they represent. Like I said, we belong to the hip-hop culture. The hip-hop culture that I came up under. I was born in the Bronx, 1975. Hip-hop was born in the Bronx, 1972. So I'm considering myself hip-hop. That's the frequency. That's the operating system. These are my first teachers, okay? This is who gave me the knowledge. Because they had that pillar that was missing in hip hop, which was the fifth pillar that is called culture, AKA consciousness. That's what we returned. That's what the community has returned to the people. Look, they were on it back then. Rakim Allah, KRS-One, which is an acronym for knowledge reigns supreme over nearly everyone. Criminal minded. So they had street consciousness mixed with book smarts. That's called hip hop. Hip, meaning that I'm hip, I'm intelligent. Hop, meaning that I'm active, I'm willing to move, I'll bust a nigga head. Okay? Hop, the active principle in hip hop. That's what you get. So that was, they were exemplifying all of the tenets of hip hop. When it was functioning in its organic state, when it was functioning in its alkaline state, this is what you get. This is why they had a golden era, because they were utilizing all of the pillars and functioning properly. That's what you get. These people were raised up by Noble Drew Ali, Malcolm X, Elijah Muhammad. Muhammad Ali was spitting bars, he was rhyming. They were influenced by these people. So look at how it had our brothers and sisters glowing. Look at the, I mean, you can see 10% of visible light, but I see light. I see a light in my brothers and my sisters, okay? They were dropping supreme knowledge. So when the industry got a hold of this, when they realized it was taking place, because like I said, the whole thing about the Black Messiah, look at the goddesses. All three of them left this planet. They're no longer with us. The power that Beyonce has over our sisters and the influence that Beyonce has over young women around the world and the influence that many of these other singers have over not only just the women, but the brothers too. Aaliyah was singing to your heart. Selena was singing to their hearts. Mm-hmm. Left Eye was singing to their hearts. So look at the potential in this picture alone. What if each one of these women were able to begin to see the goddess within themselves? They were already seeing the goddess within themselves. Look at what Aaliyah was waking up to. She was waking up into her ancient comedic self. Mm-hmm. Left Eye was with Dr. Sabi. Left Eye was in Honduras. Me and KT, the arts degree, were very good friends. They were having many conversations on higher levels. She was fully into herself. Okay? And I can't speak for Selena, but I'm sure that somebody else can. You know what I mean? So these are messianic forces. Because Left Eye began doing what? Talking against the system. She began to talk against eating unhealthy. Uh-huh. She began to talk against vaccinations. She began to talk talk favorably for doing what? Using herbs, right? Homeopathic remedies, right? Health and wellness. A kick that everybody is all of a sudden on right now, but they wasn't on it back in the day. They wasn't on it when she was talking about that. Whole Foods wasn't the you know what I'm saying? Whole Foods is like a church. So people equate health and wellness to Whole Foods. Vicariously, by doing that, you give the Europeans the credit. That's not what they're known for. They're known for eating raw meat and things of that nature. That's not... How is it that we give credit to a people for bringing foods to us that's indigenous to our land? It would be that. How about that? Huh? How about that? They not giving you European foods. They like, yo, this stuff that's grown in India. Yeah. You need to come and do yoga with me. How? Why are you going to teach me yoga? Huh? That's like the hippies following the Indians. I'm not sitting in your teepee. I got my own. You culture vulturing. So now you're going to Whole Foods, exorbitant prices, and the shit is all GMO. For what? That's not their food. I'm not paying them for nothing. So I be stealing stuff. So this whole conversation is summed up in this passage right here. One of their thinkers, Noam Chomsky. Mm-hmm. He talks about the white people's fear of revenge for slavery is deeply rooted in American culture. Like I said, the greatest religion on this planet is Americanism. They call it Americana. It's not Christianity. It's not Islam. It's not Buddhism. It's McDonald's. It's John Wayne. You understand? It's white is right. It's niggas is slaves. It's Americana. It's manifest destiny, right? It's blonde hair and blue eyes is good. If you black, get to the back. If you white, you right. That's Americana. Make America great again. All of that stuff, right? Yeah, that part. So he's like, yo, one of their greatest fears is that y'all gonna wake up to what's really taking place. You're gonna hurt us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You're gonna become more savage than what we were in our savage self. Not knowing that we don't really, it ain't about all of that. Neuroscience confirms your subconsciousness shapes your reality. Neuroscience has drifted off a little bit in the direction of where Freud was going in terms of interpretations of whether your unconscious mind is sending you particular hitting signals and so on. But the idea that there's this massive amount that's happening under the hood, that part was correct. And so Freud really nailed that. And he lived before the blossoming of modern neuroscience. He was able to do this by outside observation and looking how people acted. He was people watching, right? And they were doing all of these tests on the people, how they do all of those medical tests where they were taking slaves and doing all of these tests, or they were paying people peanuts to come and work on them and to observe them and like they do today. Yo, you out of money, you want to come and smoke some cake too? Come on in. Yo, you need some bread? You want to give us some of your sperm? You might have immortal genes like Henrietta Lacks. You giving them your blood, you giving them your donor, you organ donating, you letting them take hearts from you, livers, your blood, your placenta, all of these things. But Oprah's going to show you the movie where they took our sister's blood, and not only did they coat the space shuttle, they used her immortal cells. What does that mean? That means that she has cells that never die. What does that mean? That means that we are immortal, black woman. It starts with you first, because you're giving birth.
Uh-huh.
If I have immortal cells, it's because I got them from you. But you have immortal cells, meaning, just think about vampire. Without the aspect of the parasite, just think about them living forever and always being young. Black don't crack takes on a whole nother meaning. Meaning that there's amongst us different genetic strains, different genetic variations that they didn't washed out of us, that they didn't put on a sex farm. And remember, the sex farms were utilized to dilute the genetic pool of people who had immortal cells. To do what? Give birth to them so they can have immortal cells. That's how they did it. Your womb was sacred. You was not laying down with no goddamn Brad Pitt back in the day. That wasn't even an option. Show me a kingdom in Africa where the Europeans got off the boat and our women was like, oh my goodness, it's George Clooney. It just didn't happen like that. They was like, look at the funny people with the little wee-wees. You understand? They were just examining them, but they were not looked at as, you know, people or men that our women were into. But there's a reverse when it came to us. I'm just saying. There's songs written about us. There's novels written about us. There's historical accounts of when we got off of those ships, the women were just going crazy. I'm talking about globally. All right? So that has a lot to do with genetics. That has a lot to do with phenotype. That has a lot to do with women could look at a man and she knows an alpha just by scanning him. She knows if she wants to procreate with that man based off of how he appears. There's certain things that she can see in him. So they could look at a person and be like, nah, he's diseased. I ain't with that. He's a lame. I'm not recreating that. Some of that has been lost nowadays because of this whole matrix that we live in, but that's what took place, all right? The power of the internet, of course, we all know, is very strong, okay? Internet killed the television, you know what I mean? It's a disruptor. Think about Galactus, the comic book, the Galacticus, Silver Surfer, how it was eating things. The internet is an eater. It eats upon things. It's a disruptor. Email is a disruptor to the post office. Uber is a disruptor to the taxi business. You dig what I'm saying? Airbnb is a disruptor to the hotel. It's eating it. It's not just a disruptor. It's eating it. It's destroying it. Okay? The internet ate the television. So there's more people are tuned in into the internet more than they're tuned into quote unquote mainstream media in the television. People are breaking the television and throwing them out, or they're watching YouTube through the television. All right? I'm showing this because what took place over the summer that nobody wants to talk about anymore had a lot to do with Donald Trump getting into the seat of power. I went back and I showed you that one of their greatest fears is not just of a black and white messiah, but their greatest fear is of the people waking up and doing what they did in Haiti. For the people waking up and doing what they did at Seminoles. For the people waking up and doing what the Maroons did. You understand? So when this was sensationalized over the, because remember, there's a whole bunch of police dying every week. You don't know about that. You don't hear about that. Because the assailants don't have our complexion. They utilize these stories right here. The verdict is still out as if this was an actor or not, because each person, both our brother, God bless him, Alton Sterling, I mean, not Alton Sterling, I'm sorry. This brother, Harry Cosmos, and the other brother, Mika Johnson, they were all ex-military, all right? When it comes to ex-military, there's mind control taking place. There's all kind of ops that are taking place with military, with the inoculations and all kind of stuff. With the Manchurian candidate aspect, they're responsible for a lot of the shootouts that you see. They're responsible for a lot of the quote-unquote mass shootings and whatnot. So we're like, yo, what's going on in Iraq? What's going on in Afghanistan? Are they programming our people? Are these niggas remote control? Okay, because they can do it at this point now. So the brother here renounced the slave name, joined an anti-black government group. So he had a manifesto, right? Gavin Long is his name. He had a manifesto. They don't necessarily want us to see the manifesto. I read the manifesto. The manifesto was very conscious. He articulated himself in his frustrations and his purpose. Okay? He said, you know, that he was avenging the death. He was making a martyr out of the people that he was tired of being victims. He was tired of seeing victims. And he understood in order to make them a martyr, you had to go eye for an eye.
He was like, fuck it, Americana. I'm going American on you niggas. Okay? Because that's what they taught him in the army. Because he went across seas and he got a medal for putting in work for Uncle Sam doing eye for eye work, tooth for tooth work. So he was like, it applies home. Right? And they kind of buried that. He has a book. I saw his book as well. It's called Cosmos. You know, the brother was no dummy. You know what I mean? God bless his soul. And he sacrificed himself. And there's another case that took place with the Dallas 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is also questionable. This is very questionable because when they killed the brother, they killed him with a robot.
Shit.
You never saw footage of, you never heard any of his confessions. You never saw the correct footage of the shootout. He got cornered, he got bombed, and he got killed. But what did they have? They had proof, they had propaganda that this man was part of the Black Power movement, part of the conscious movement, because they had they threw a picture with him and Professor Gripta. When have you ever seen a suspected killer and they throw a picture up with a killer with somebody else? They don't do that. They blur their face out. Like, have they shown any of these white killers, these young killers, chilling with Marilyn Manson?
Nah.
Or the Beatles and shit like that? Like, because you know they got pictures with them. Why would they put Professor's rip around his picture around the world? So this is an implication. So Rip is all RBG'd up. He's with my dude right there. You know what I mean? They're like, yo, RBG is out here killing the police. We got to get at them. They jumped past Black Lives Matter because this was a shootout at the Black Lives Matter rally. The next day, the dude with the blue vest was at the White House with Obama. So it couldn't be a Black Lives Matter affair because you can't get presidential clearance if there was a cop killed at your goddamn rally. It don't make sense. So they're not looking at Black Lives Matter. They're looking at conscious people, all right? So there's all of these new weapons, drones, surveillance, and all of these other things that they've been practicing in Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan. They militarized the police. They militarized the local police. As you can see at the riots, how they're coming out with the tanks and whatnot. Okay? Our people giving the police power, giving them their blessings. There's more police killings in United States of America than any other country. And when you add it all up, I'm talking about continents and countries, all right? This is showing that YouTube is doing more numbers than television. So what we're doing on these YouTube channels, like Kia Light Productions, like Black Magic 363, like Sonetta, like URL when they're doing their lectures, they are reaching an audience at unprecedented numbers. What effect does that have on consciousness of the people? What effect does that have on waking up the gods that are innate inside of our people? A profound effect. And they know this. They're watching the metadata. They're watching the numbers. They're crunching the numbers. They're taking an assessment of the people that are waking up in this time where it said that your ass is supposed to wake up. This is the appropriate age. This was prophecy. You think that they didn't catch that one? You dig what I'm saying? This is not the new age. This is not all of that stupid stuff that these old hippies, these liberals who play both sides of the fence are trying to convince you. No, this is your time. All right? This is the age of enlightenment. This is the Aquarian age. This is the time for our people to rise back up after going through our dark ages. All right? And you're going to see a lot of darkness. You're going to see a lot of turmoil. Death and destruction may become very rampant, but it was always rampant. It was always in our community. It's always been there. Is that a fact? All right? So I'm just showing the guide. This is a pricing guide of WorldStar. This is the traffic on WorldStar. WorldStar is the 1,209 website around the world. On the Alexa ranking, WorldStar ranks at the 1,209 around the world. It is billions of websites. So our people are being shown around the world in all of their glory. Okay? In all of their glory. So whatever WorldStar is showing the world, that's the perception of the world has about us. That's the biggest black media platform on the planet. And the brother who ran it got murdered. Uh-huh. I don't know what the fuck. I don't care what nobody said. You're not just dying at a massage parlor.
Yeah, yeah.
After signing the deal with MTV. It don't work like that.
Uh-huh.
Okay? George Bush Sr., Henry Kissinger, and all of these people from the 40s are still here. You seen when they wheeled him out at the Super Bowl. He ain't going nowhere. So they all alive, but all our people dying at 30 and 40. I'm not buying it. I'm not buying it. Okay? Too much influence, too much power, too much opportunity. Negativity rewires your brain. It's been said that our subconsciousness programming. I'm talking about all of this subconscious programming because I really want to get into what is hip-hop. All right, the Great Divide. This is a breakdown of the hip hop industry. These are the people who own your image. These are the people who own the information that's being given to your children. These are the people who are responsible for feeding you. You are what you eat. I'm not just talking about the food that we just ate. What you watching on Worldstar, what you listening to in a Breakfast Club, all of these things are what you eat because you eat through your eyes, you eat through your ears, okay? So they can effeminize you through the music, through the videos, through perception, through suggestion. They can make you, they can devolve you. They can make you a savage. They can make you think being savage is cool. Right?
Yep.
In a time where it's not safe to be a savage. Because they're getting ready to purge savages. Savage people are getting ready to say, look at the savages, when they the savage. Corporate structure, this is just a breakdown. Electronic music tricks us into liking songs. A lot of the music are electronically based now. They are hypnotizing you. They are tricking you into liking it. Guess what? Because you heard it 20 times in the last hour. Hotline, stupid shit like that. You know, I'm just saying, electronic music, the drums, the original music, when the music went from digital, from analog to digital and things of that nature, they had a purpose behind that. All right? There's something called an invisible government. That invisible government is in charge of all aspects of life, media, and other things. They call it the deep state. They call it the invisible government. People run around calling it the Illuminati. I call it the Council of Foreign Relations and other groups that are in power. There's many different names for it. But these people, the Council of Foreign Relations, where presidents come from, where owners of industry like food industry come from, where owners of media come from, all of these people are in the same goddamn group. You don't gotta say Illuminati no more. CFR, Council of Foreign Relations, okay? Trilateral Commission, these are groups. You could pull it up and see all of the members. So this was Edward Bernays. His book is called Propaganda. Edward Bernays in the Century of Self. Gotta study him. These are the people who shape the thinking of society today, okay? These are their conscious, this is the conscious community of the 20s, of the 30s. The Hitler and the Nazis were basing their propaganda and their campaigns off of. They were reading books from thinkers of these days and times who were telling them how to put the people under complete control. How to take, remember, they changed the school system and modeled it after the Germans. The Germans had a model and a way of creating slaves and robots out of their out of the people that were in their school system. So America adopted that. Now you got Betsy DeVos over education. She's going to trump it up a whole nother level to where your children will be fourth class permanent citizens, where they're going to think that they came out of, you know, they just popped out of nowhere as slaves. They contributed nothing to mankind. They, you know what I mean? All of the negative things that will create self-hate and have an inferior complex upon the minds of our people so we don't function properly in society. That's how they rocking up people to sleep. And it has a lot to do with neuroscience, neurology. Remember, when music becomes non-music, in recent years, hold on a minute, because I don't want to keep, we was going to do a 30-minute Q&A. I'm asking permission to continue with the information, and we can do like a 10-minute Q&A real quick.
Definitely.
Right?
Go ahead, brother.
And I'm saying that if there's some powerful questions, I'm saying to the family, ask them while we going in, and I'll do it while, because I need this information to get out. All right?
So, in recent years, the content of mainstream popular music appears to have undergone some rather drastic changes, and the inclusion of pro-social values featured in songs seems to be gradually on the decline. Meaning that if the top 20 songs are dealing with your lower self, meaning if the top 20 songs is telling you to get money, and I'm with getting money, I'm with currency, I'm about pro-currency, I'm not a poor righteous teacher, I'm about accumulation of wealth, I'm about tapping into self-wealth, I'm about self-empowerment, I want to see my people return to glory in their glorious states, because I identify us as being the original haves, not the have-nots, because we come from mineral-rich lands, it's in our veins. So how the hell are you going to tell a young God, how are you going to tell somebody from my generation that you can't want to have? I'm not doing that. Okay? I'm not doing that. But what I would say is this, that if the way to get money, right, is the message is construed, and the shit is looping from something that we were learning 30 years ago, you're playing games. Because you live in a society right now where it has upgraded, but your music ain't upgraded. Okay? Jay-Z is damn near a billionaire, and he's telling you kind of certain different ways. He became a hedge fund manager the other day. If he don't put that in his bars, then he's leading you astray. That's all I'm saying. Nas is a billion, he's an angel investor, hedge fund, he's into technology. If he don't put that in his rhymes, he's leading you astray. He's telling you to be Escobar season and all of these other things, but he ain't really, why you can't articulate how to be a goddamn technopreneur? Why you can't articulate how you a hedge fund manager? Our babies need to know about that. You know what I'm saying? You gotta make that shit cool. Like how you made flipping birds cool. Switch up the program, switch up the message. That's all I'm saying. The effects on the young mind. There's a lot of effects that this music is having on the young mind. They're sexualizing our babies, and then people are like, oh my goodness, you know what I'm saying? If somebody ever touched my daughter, well, what if your daughter touched somebody else? Because of the programming. What if your son touched somebody else? Because he's looking at Young Thug in a dress, and they're telling them it's normalized. He's like, oh god damn it, I'm gonna just go touch Timmy in the schoolyard and all this crazy shit. Our people are being indoctrinated by this. When our daughter saw Miley Cyrus pop up back up with a virus. She went from Hannah Montana, and then she popped back up like that. What do you think that did to your daughter's mind? She was watching her as Hannah Montana. She normalizing the behavior. This is not by coincidence. This is not just to sell records. Okay? A grimoire is a book of spells. Your rhyme book is a grimoire. Spelling, grimoire comes from grimoire. What you do with your balls and whatnot, that's casting spells. Abracadabra is casting spells by making words rhyme. It's a Hebrew word for I speak it, so I make it reality. So when Biggie came along, he was wearing mad hoodies and his Timbs was leaning. And he was repping, you know, fat ugly bastards who Timbs was leaning, selling crack to your mama. But then he threw Versace on with Versace glasses. And he was like, yo, I'm a Willie. He spoke that into reality. And people conformed to that. And he terraformed a whole generation. Okay? When Jeezy and Yeezy and all of these other people, the T.I. and all of them, they start trapping. They want to talk about trap rapping and all of that. Right? Hold on. When they came, and they came with this information, right? Right? When they came with the Dope Boy swag, right? T.I. came with the trap music first, and did it evolve, or did it devolve? Right? How many ways can you say that you sell us a lot? How many people do we need to tell us that? So, when this became the conversation, but then the conversation got co-opted a bit, you dig what I'm saying? And then the conversation becomes real life, you know, you gotta begin to ask yourself, are our people affected by that? Because remember, we're suffering from a government program that started with the Luciano crime family, with the Genovese crime family, with the CIA,
in the 50s when they said, yo, this was part of the war on the Black Messiah. They was like, yo, we want to bring this opium into America because we want to fund a war that's taking place somewhere else. So they was like, yo, we're going to pick some people. The Italian mob was like, we're going to flood Harlem with heroin. And as a result of flooding it with heroin, we're going to raise a few of them up to be the big willies of that time. And that was the beginning of our drug dependency, where it became, because our people have always utilized what is identified as sacraments. You know what I mean? Things to help us defocalize and things of that nature. We always utilize that peyote, you know what I mean? Tobacco and all of this other stuff. But this was chemical warfare. This was created in labs. Crack cocaine is what is known as a chemical war. That's part of a chemical war, you know what I mean, tactic. That is a weapon of mass destruction, okay? Because the purpose of it was not to get rich or die trying. The reason why that shit is in the hood is because somebody put it there. So our people are now 13th Amendment slaves. Slavery did not get abolished. If you are if your ass got a jacket and you got locked up, who got that? You a legal slave. According to the law, according to the Constitution, go and watch the Netflix documentary 13.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And these labels, when there was a war on drugs, these labels started signing drug dealers. These labels are owned, right, by big corporations, right? These big corporations, the Sony, Universal, these got shareholders. These people got mad shit. How the hell is a shareholder gonna just sit there and be like, all right, you can sign mad drug dealers and niggas killing each other. There's a war on drug, there's a war on crime, there's a war on poverty, but we shareholders and we cool with you. But no, the shareholders was told, buy some shares in the prison, my nigga. You got shares in Sony, but you could have shares in the jails because I promise you that's where we're gonna lead them. And I wish I could go further. We gotta wrap it up. We're gonna take some quick, we're gonna be able to take a quick, two questions and we're gonna close it out.
We
will continue this conversation very near future. I'm only 20% into my lecture. I wanna say thank you for your time, your patience, and your love. Peace.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Any questions?
Let's see if they got questions.
So you
made
the case.
Nah,
it won't reach.
Huh?
It won't reach.
Go ahead, brother.
Hold on. I want you to because we're not shooting so much.
Tell them when you came.
Yeah.
Is it good?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right now. Living in Hawaii for about 10 years, originally from here, from the East Coast, New Jersey. So what I was going to say, and I'm sure you would have touched on this, I know you only got through part of the lecture, but you know, you made a really good case using historic examples and evidence and paperwork and basically showing that there's an energy, right, that exists, which basically is trying to stomp out or stop our energy or our figures from galvanizing people in such a way to liberate them, to empower them, and so forth. And so we have history, we have, you know, all the hindsight vision and all that kind of stuff. So my question to you is, because I view that as an energy, what's your message and what's the counter energy to that?
Mm-hmm. The counter energy to that is what we're doing here tonight. Not gonna find nothing outside of self that's gonna get you out of the predicament of being in a society, being inside of a power structure. Remember, I said dominant power, this is dominant society, right? And the dominant power structure is going to do everything within its power to remain dominant. So they, as a people, black people are suffering from so many ailments. But the answers to some of our ailments lie within our leadership. It lies within our messengers. It lies within our organizations that were actually put there to be the crutch, okay? To break us out of these different spells. to bring our people together like you had a Nation of Islam with hundreds of, with thousands of members. The power of thousands of members is the economic base. The powers of thousands of members, the fact that you can manufacture, you can produce and do all of these other things. The power of a large base is that now you can create all of these different engineers, people that are in media. All of them will be supported by their different, the people that are belong to their organization. So the power or the countermeasure to the rise, to the people going against the rise of a Black Messiah or COINTELPRO 2.0 is that we have to be able to tap into all of the components that are being used against us. Media is being used against us. What do we do? Well, you better grab media. You better create your own media. Technology is being used against us. What do? Well, you need to take technology into your own hands. I wish I had time to read the definition of technology. It's not what you think it is. It is not what you think it is. You think technology is just these phones and these computers. Technology is what we're doing right now. Building, sharing ideas and concepts, solving problems, answering questions, utilizing information that exists out there and then applying it. That's technology. So we have to create a income stream, different income streams. Our brothers are going to jail. Our brothers are getting locked up. Our sisters are getting locked up. Our sisters are selling their bodies because they feel, because of the radio and other outside influences telling them there's only two ways to get money. So where are our Black entrepreneurs that are coming amongst us to give us the other 1,000 ways to get money? Because I know that that exists because I study and I see it. Why is nobody coming around and telling us all of the ways to get money in the technological era? Why nobody came amongst us and told us about trust? Nobody come amongst us and tell us about business credit. Nobody's coming amongst us and tell us about any of the different things. The people come from shanty towns into America. That's why they're so mad. They're like, yo, you can't shut us down. They got people coming from quote unquote, I don't like to say third world, because like I said, Europe is the original third world. But they got people coming from places with a gross, where the GPA, the money that, you know, the basic medium income is $5 a week. And then they come to America, America hits them to all of this stuff, teaches them how to open up business, get loans, and do all of these things. Why they not teaching that to the hood? So it's on us. We are so religious. We are so divided. We are so, you know, traumatized by things that we had no control over. You dig what I'm saying? We so silly as a people sometimes that we're not focusing on, we don't have our eyes on the prize. We're not focusing on being who we were meant to be. We're not focusing on being who we came here, reincarnated here to be. You gotta be able to live out your purpose. So we gotta align ourselves with doctrines that feed our energy, feed that soul. We have to be fearless. We have to be courageous. We have to utilize the times that we are living in. We're living in this Trump era. This is a good time for consciousness, okay? Because people are beginning to wake up on purpose. Trump is helping people wake up. Yes! Many different scientists, even all the way up to Elon Musk, who's a billionaire, that this is a quote-unquote false reality. This is a holographic reality, meaning that this is a simulation. Mm-hmm. The jury is still out if this is real. Because remember, consciousness is whatever you put your attention to. There's been tests that have been proven that nothing exists until you look at it. Okay? As in when you're playing a video game, that corner doesn't, when you turn the corner, that world begins to terraform as you turn the corner. You dig what I'm saying? So all is mental. All kind of religions, all kind of practices, all kind of spiritual systems says that all this world that we live in exists within the mind of the all-knowing, the omnipotent. The way that the all-knowing had to even experience itself is by negating itself. How could the all-knowing even know itself until it had to create a reality in which it existed in? You feel what I'm saying? We only see 10% of the light spectrum. We're incomplete. We have not seen life forms outside of this planet. We're incomplete. We don't realize that water is not even of this planet. We're incomplete. Okay? It's foreign to the planet.
And we're composed of 70% water, and then we have stardust in us. Then we have traces of gold in us. We got copper in us. We have all of these other things that are in us. Our composite. So you are responsible for your reality. Have you ever controlled anything around you? Have you ever got so goddamn inebriated or defocalized that you saw time slow down? Have you ever had the power of mentalism where you're quote unquote clairvoyant, you can see things happening before they happen? You know what I'm saying? So there's a lot of talk. A melanated woman wrote that. She also wrote The Terminator. Her name is Sophia Stewart.
Yep.
Now they have the rise of what is known as AI. She wrote The Matrix and The Terminator. You feel me? Things that we never thought that we would see in society, we're beginning to see these things now. So as we wake up to the illusion, as we wake up to the smoke and mirrors, as we wake up to our true selves, as we wake up to the fact that we're living under all of these malware programs, all of those alt facts and all of those lies that they told us in school, in religion, at the job place, in society, through the media, it has messed up our perception. When you pop the red pill like Neo did, all of those veils begin to lift. You see the shit for what it really is. They live. Stuff like that.
Crazy movie.
So we're gonna let the God close out. I want to tell everybody once again, thank you. All right.
Yes, sir.
See us at the table when we finish. Love and light. All right.
Bless. Bless.
Fellow Scorpion. This one, fellow Scorpion.
Yes, yes.
You know me. Shout out to Brad Pitt coming through. You know. This month is like. How could I explain?
Alright. We had the gold and they took it. Yeah. Rapping about how we in the field, cause the slaves couldn't. Our eyes open, but we ain't looking. Lost files, we learned it, however they put it. Wait. You see the big picture? Well, I see it large. Money rule the world, but paying attention is free of charge. Young king with a destiny to be a god. I'm just looking at my reflection when I see the stars. I don't wanna see no man down, we don't need the raw. That man gotta feed his family like we're feeding us. But in this fucked up world, this either eat a star. Just for a new pair of sneakers, niggas are sneaking on us. Walk a mile in my shoes, so why they scheming off? My mind racing, guess that's why I used to dream of cars. Bugattis and Jaguars just eating far. I'm in a whole nother lane than these people are. I keep it a $150, you can see the scars.
Sure.
My fin be involved just to see me evolve. Y'all be leaving y'all's, well, we believe in ours. Damn. I remember getting that speech from mom. I never feel like it hurt me to help. But I'm starting to feel like I don't even come first to myself. But they call me crazy because I converse with myself. Man, we all got dirt on the shelf. Don't play the victim. It's a lot of shit you learn by yourself. Pay attention. Gotta keep in touch with the bars, but stay from prison. We got caught up in a trap and we trapped as a way to get it. I was late for dinner because I was outside making chicken. My mama was making. I was just trying to make a difference, have more to learn, get wiser with decisions. I gotta make a living, man, this guy is on a mission. I started playing broke cause the dollars brought attention. They wanna chill, never wanted to aim before I blew up. They say I'm acting different, I ain't changed, I just grew up. And them niggas was two-faced, now a nigga two up. When I had 2 cents, they ain't get two fucks.
Talk to him, dog. Talk to him, dog. Talk to him, dog. Talk to him, dog.
When you make it, they say you left them behind. But that was never the case. I just went for what's mine. I had to step up the grind. I think smarter, better your mind. Why ask for a handout if I'm better with mine? Ripping niggas, crossing out bars, directing the lines. I ain't easily satisfied like the rest of you guys. I'm trying to build the empire. Chess is a lion, chess is a lion. Young king ready and rising, he was next up. Now his neck heavy with diamonds in my path. I see a couple rings better than Sonics. You ain't catching what I'm saying, you better with one. So you remember the legacy, the chess and the dowry. Gotta let the haters hate, that's just regular gossip. Young body, old soul, I'm ahead of my time. Far
on,
we get better with time.
Talk to him. Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir.
You already know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This is the generation that we are representing for. This is who we riding for. This is the future. And that's why it's important for us to embrace the future. The young gods,
God said that he wanted to be God. I said God is a verb. Godding. Mm-hmm. Consciousness is a verb. It's doing. All right? We all have a place up here. So salute to God for what he do. You know what I mean? And it is what it is. And that's how you counter the spells on our people. You raise up the youth. You raise up the sisters. You raise our brothers up. And we're going to see this thing change overnight.
Yep.
Facts. All right? Salute. And the next lecture that we're going to do here is the evolution will be digitized 2.0 and the facts initiative, because we got solutions.
Definitely come back.
We just need the attention of the people, because we've been through hundreds of years of spells. It's not going to happen in 3 hours. We're not going to be able to break it.
Uh-huh.
In just 3 hours, we got to be able to build and socialize. All right? Love and light to the family. Peace to Kia Life Productions. Know the legend. Salute to everybody on the live streams and whatnot.
Yes, sir.
We can catch up with y'all. Peace. And I want to get everybody's email before we get out of here.
Okay.
Right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hey.
All day, baby. All day, man. All day, man.
Good shit, Chaz. Good shit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
What you need me to do, G?
You want me to still keep this running, right? Oh, you know?
You can try.
Sirizzy. Yo, yeah, a little something, man. Yeah, Chessman, what's up, man?
Salute. Appreciate you, King. You're ready.
You got Chessy at the conscious event, you know what I mean? Like, it's not just battle rap. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's not just battle rap. Talk to us, Chess. What we had going on here, man? Yeah.
How you like the event, Chess?
Yeah, wait.
It's definitely a dope event, man. I'm definitely going to come back.
It's
way more.
Knowledge guy in the building. Yeah, we gotta let people know, man. It's more than just battle rap, man. Yeah. We had Show Off come through, bless us too, with his little death poetry jamming and all that. Huh? My fault, fam.